An interview with Brigitte Gabrielle. Few people in the world today know more about the religion of Islam, its aims, its direction, and its intended goals than Brigitte Gabrielle. Today you'll hear Brigitte's firsthand account of the religion of Islam and how she learned what the religion actually is. Here's evangelist Jimmy Swaggart.
What a delight to be with you today. This is evangelist Jimmy Swaggart, and I'm very pleased to have Donnie and Francis with us today. I'm very glad to have them, and we're glad to have you because you are the reason for this programming. And we're very, very happy today to have a very special guest that I've been telling you about the last couple of weeks, Brigitte Gabrielle. And Brigitte is used of the Lord possibly as few women today as it regards some of the great problems that's facing our nation, I should say. Let me make a few statements before we get started here today. I personally believe that the United States of America is facing problems that are greater than we have ever faced before in our history. Greater than Pearl Harbor, greater than monolithic former Soviet communism, greater than the Cold War, greater than Vietnam, or whatever the case may have been. Some of those were trying times, and if sons and daughters were lost, that was very trying for the parents and the loved ones. But what we're facing today, I personally feel is greater. I personally feel is more dangerous. I personally feel is a greater threat to our nation, to our way of life, than we have ever faced before in history. Unfortunately, most of the leaders of our nation do not seem to see that. Unfortunately, the nation seems to be very much unaware of what is at our doorsteps, to be frank with you. I don't know of any person in the world today, there may be many, but I'm not personally acquainted with them, who understands this threat, who understands this danger, who understands this problem, as this young lady that's seated here beside us today. Brigitte was born and raised in Lebanon, and you are Arab, I would think. Am I correct on that or not? Correct me.
Christians of the Middle East are not Arabs, but during the Islamic invasion, we were stripped out of our languages and forced to speak the Arabic language and became Arab phones, basically people who speak the Arabic language.
But not really Arab.
No.
Well, I'm glad I cleared that up. I'm going to ask Brigitte to deal with some aspects. She can go in any direction she so desires. Of her early days, her birth, her being raised in the country of Lebanon. We have been in this beautiful country. At least it was years past. When we were there, it was in the midst of the so-called Peace for Galilee campaign, and yes, it was torn all to pieces. We were taken by the Israeli authorities as a news crew all the way into Beirut. And that was about the time, I suppose, that you were having some tremendous problems at that time.
Yes.
Now, I've read your book, and I think that this book is one of the most necessary works that need to be carefully addressed, read, studied, of any book in this nation today as it regards the subject matter at hand. It's entitled, Because They Hate. Now, I want to know some things about this. Brigitte, am I pronouncing that correctly?
Yes.
Close.
Yes,
close.
You are.
Close. You were raised Roman Catholic, really. Am I correct?
Yes, Maronite Christians. The majority of the Christians in Lebanon are Maronite,
okay,
which is the same thing. We come under the Catholic Church, the
okay,
Pope, the Vatican is the head of the
All
church.
Right. And you were raised in a little town not too very far from the Israeli-Lebanese border, correct?
Correct.
And your life was uneventful and very pleasant and enjoyable until the whole world exploded. I am correct on that as well.
Correct.
Your parents were professional people. Your dad made an excellent living.
Yes.
And you, as a young girl, enjoyed life, I
yes,
suppose.
Yes.
And then something happened that completely disrupted all of that. And would you begin there or wherever you desire?
Yes. I actually would like to begin talking about Lebanon. Many people do not realize that Lebanon used to be the only majority Christian country in the Middle East. When people think of the Middle East, they think the Middle East is all Muslim, all Arabs. They don't realize that Lebanon used to be the only democracy, Arabic democracy in the Middle East. Democracy is not starting with Iraq today. In the 40s, when Lebanon got its independence from France, we were set up as a republic, very much like the United States of America. We were the only Arabic, supposedly, country that elects its officials. And because of our Judeo-Christian majority and heritage, we were good in business. We focused on growing the country. We were multicultural. We were open-minded. We were fair. We were tolerant. We opened our arms and welcomed everybody who wanted to come to our country because we wanted to share with them the westernization that we had created in the heart of the Arabic
Can
world.
Can I interrupt you a second?
Yes.
What was the predominant religious persuasions of Lebanon at that time?
The predominant religion among the Christians were the Maronites. It was Christian.
No, I'm talking about the religions as a whole. How many Muslims were there, et cetera, et cetera?
The majority were Christians. The minority were Sunnis, Muslims. The Shiites were a small fraction of the Islamic in Lebanon, and they were basically based in the south. And there is a very small Druze minority, which also a sect of Islam.
And you go ahead and continue with your statement about Lebanon.
We opened our hearts to all the Arabic world. Muslims from all around the Arabic world used to send their children to study in our universities because we had built the best universities in the Arabic world. They graduated and worked in our economy because we had built the best economy in the heart of the Middle East, and we didn't have any oil. Lebanon became Paris of the Middle East, the banking capital of the Middle East. National Geographic magazine in the mid-60s, 1965, had a front cover on National Geographic magazine said, Lebanon, the Garden of Eden, Eden of the Middle East. And this is what we had become. But sadly, Jimmy, as the years passed, we, the Christians, became the minority and the Muslims became the majority.
Well, I want to know how that happened. That's what I was about to ask. How is it? If the Muslims were a minority, you didn't say how small a minority or how large a minority, but at any rate, how did they come to gain the ascendancy in the nation?
Because we Christians do not have as many children as the Muslims do. We Christians get married to one spouse until death do us part. We have two, three, maybe four children by a stretch. From the time our children are born, we start thinking about what education we're going to give them, what schools we're going to send them to, what lifestyle we're going to give them, what neighborhoods we're going to live in for our children. The Muslims, on the other hand, are allowed to marry up to four wives at a time, not in a lifetime. At a time. All a Muslim man has to do to divorce his wife is say you are divorced three times in a row and she is divorced, and then he can marry another one. They have a lot of children out of every wife. Today the average Islamic family throughout the world is 10 children.
I believe you said in your book Osama bin Laden had what, 56 children?
He is one out of 53 children.
53.
He himself has 27. And we haven't even started talking about his other 52 brothers and sisters and how many children they have.
So there are a lot of bin Ladens around, huh?
There are a lot of bin Ladens around.
And so you're saying that the very high excessive birth rate is what helped them to become the majority?
Yes, it's their high birth rate, and also us opening our borders and welcoming Muslims into our country, us thinking, you know, they're gonna love our way of life. I mean, all the Arab sheikhs used to come to Lebanon with their family to vacation and party because my country offered them the freedom that their countries forbid. Like I mentioned, the Muslims who came to study in our country, they graduated and worked in our economy. But also what aggravated the situation. See, we always had the situation contained between the Muslim Lebanese and the Christian Lebanese. But what aggravated the situation was the influx of the Palestinians into Lebanon, especially out of Jordan in the 1970s, when Lebanon was the only country to accept the third wave of Palestinian refugees into the country. While their Muslim brothers did not want them, we, the Christian Lebanon, took them in.
So you are saying that the situation may proceed without much difficulty, providing that the Muslims are not yet ready to make their move, and
right.
they are inferior regarding numbers. But once they gain the upper hand, that's when everything changes.
Exactly. Once they gained the upper hands, once the Palestinians came to Lebanon and the Muslims became the majority, they put their heads together and they declared jihad in the country.
In other words, they said, we're going to take over this nation.
We're going to take over this nation. What Yasser Arafat wanted to do was basically create a base from which to fight Israel, kill the Jews and throw them into the sea. Something he tried to do in Jordan but failed because of the dictatorship of the king. We in Lebanon took him in, and he was able to use our democracy, our open-mindedness, our fair, our tolerance, our multiculturalism against us to topple our democracy. We, the Christians, refused to read the writings on the wall. We refused to listen to what our enemy was saying. We judged our enemy based on our own standards. We could not believe that even though our enemy was telling us exactly what they wanted to do, we could not believe that they mean it. We would always come up with our own translation of what they're trying to say.
Well, that's just what's happening in America today.
This is exactly what is happening in America today. America, as an open society, as a fair society, as a tolerant society, as a multicultural society, as an open border society, look at what's happening through the borders, which I will touch on later as we get into what's happening in our country. But I see the same signs in America. Our enemy today is telling us exactly what they want to do. You listen to the Al-Qaeda tapes, you listen to Al-Zawahiri, you listen to Al-Zarqawi, you listen to Osama bin Laden, you listen to Gaddam. All the tapes that are coming out of Al-Qaeda are saying, we want to establish an Islamic Khalifa, we want to spread Islam all throughout the world, this is a holy war. They're not hiding it.
So you're hearing the same rhetoric now as it regards this nation as you heard as a little girl back in Lebanon.
Exactly.
A few years ago.
Exactly. And in Lebanon,
go ahead.
Once the Muslims became the majority and they got the upper hand, they organized, they came out publicly. Those who used to say that we're moderates, you know, only the radical Palestinians are doing this, all of a sudden, the moderates, quote unquote, the doctors, the lawyers, the educated Muslims, our next door neighbors who used to come to our barbecue picnics the weekend before were doing the massacring the weekend after once the call of jihad was declared.
Okay, Muslims who you thought were your friends.
Yes.
Muslims who y'all broke bread together.
Yeah.
The children played together and you thought they would never hurt us. Is that about right?
That's exactly
it. And what happened whenever war began?
Once the Muslims gathered, they formed an army called Jaysh Libnan al-Arabi, the Arabic Lebanese army. Again, Arab in the Middle East refers only to Muslims. The word Arabic, because Islam spread out of Arabia throughout the world, as Muslims conquered nations, they basically forced those nations either to convert to Islam or adopt Islamic culture and language. Do you know that in Arabic today, when Christians pray, they pray for Allah? This is the word supposedly in Arabic for God.
Yeah.
So in the Bible and in Christian churches, when Christians pray, they pray for Allah. In many different countries, people here in the United States do not realize that the Christians of the Middle East are not Arabs. They are basically groups of Christians that were forced and subjugated under Islam. For example, in Lebanon, if you go to our churches today, we still speak the Aramaic language in our churches. Our church services are conducted throughout the world.
In Aramaic?
Today, in the 21st century, in Aramaic, the language that
Jesus spoke. Jumping ahead a few years at what is taking place in Lebanon right now, the Lebanese government that's trying to gain the upper hand, what's going on there now? Who is what?
Well, basically now, Hezbollah is in control. Hezbollah basically multiplied themselves for the last 25 years to be able to vote themselves into the government. See, this is again why the multiplication in numbers becomes so important, because once these people start voting, they basically voted themselves into the government. About 25 seats into the government are now occupied by Hezbollah. Mm. And what they're trying to do is overthrow the Lebanese government and take over the government.
Now, you were raised, really, and reading your book, you were raised to be blunt, to hate the Jews.
Well, yes, Lebanon as a country, we thought...
In those years of long ago.
Yes, those years is long ago. Now, I was a very young child. In my home, I was not taught hatred because I was raised in a Christian family.
Yeah.
Christians do not raise their kids to hate because what did Jesus taught? Jesus taught love. But the culture around me, because by the time I was a child in the 70s, the majority of the people in Lebanon were Muslims. Mm-hmm. And they...
But as a child, you really hadn't even seen a Jew, I suppose.
No, no. I've never seen a Jew until the war broke out.
What were you taught? What little you were? Like you said, your parents were Christians. They didn't teach you hate per se, but that aura or spirit was there in the country, I'm assuming.
Right, right. I remember my father had a restaurant, and I would watch television in the restaurant every night. And the news would be about the horrible Israelis, the horrible Jews, and what they're doing to the Palestinians. And of course, Lebanon, as a country who took in the Palestinian refugees, you know, Israel was vilified. So all the media in the Arabic world is controlled by the governments. Our government thought that if they would befriend or succumb to the Arabic government, that would buy us protection or brownie points as a minority in the Middle East. We were fools to believe that. So on television, they would say, Israel, Azrael, Azrael is the name of the devil. Israel is evil. The Jews are evil. The Jews are barbaric. Israel is the problem, the source of the problem of all the wars in the Middle East. And that the only time we will have peace in the Middle East is when we kill all the Jews and throw them into the sea.
Now, you really heard that type of rhetoric as
absolutely
a child.
Absolutely. All
and
over.
And from the news.
Yes.
Coming out
in
all
the news. And the people. I would sit and eat dinner at my father's restaurant. People would be sitting all around, and especially we in the South.
But even though the Christianity was predominant in Lebanon at that time, still there was great animosity against Israel.
Yes, because supposedly Israel was the enemy. And that was the feeling amongst most of the Lebanese. Not necessarily, the Christians did not hate, but they knew that Israel was the enemy. And that was a prevailing feeling. However, once the Muslim organized and they created Jaysh Libnan al-Arabi, the Arabic Lebanese army, they started killing the Christians and threatening the Christians. They started massacring the Christians and trying to take over all of Lebanon. They would walk into Christian cities and towns and massacre and destroy the churches. They would walk into our churches and they would burn the churches. They would urinate and defecate on the altar using the Bible as toilet paper. They would kill, they would take the Christian boys and slaughter them. They would nail them on crosses and then put honey on their private parts and on their chests so they can be bitten, stung by bees as they hung and died. They would walk into the bomb shelters. They would rape the women. They would behead the husbands. The last lady that worked for me, they went into her bomb shelter. They tied her to a chair. She was hiding with her family. They tied a knife to her hand and held her 16-year-old son on her lap and made her cut his own throat.
My Lord.
The monstrosities they committed were horrifying.
Okay, whenever you relate this, from your experience here in America, and people hear what they will hear right now, they are hearing what you're saying, what do the American people believe? What do they think when they hear you say these kind of things? Do they think that, well, that was just some fanatics in the religion of Islam, and it does not characterize that religion. The religion is really a peaceable, honorable religion, and these are just some fanatics or whatever the case. Is that the spirit you're getting out there, or would our people, our leaders, hopefully be coming to the place that they realize the religion is the cause of this? It's not just a few wild-eyed, evil fanatics. It's the religion. Now, do you agree with what I'm saying here about the religion itself being the cause of all of these problems you've just mentioned, this horror?
I agree with you 100%, and here is why. As we educate America about the background of Islam, see, Americans and Westerners in general, up until 9/11, 2001, they could care less. They didn't care about Islam. People in America were more interested in watching a documentary about Madonna in the last 25 years than watching a documentary about radical Islam. However, since September 11th, we started seeing the shootings of the school in Beslan, shooting children by Muslims, kidnapping, hijacking high school and terrorizing the children. The bombings in Bali, the bombings in Madrid, the bombings in London. It's not only the United States. But I'm going to take it back further to discuss governments and religion. Under the name of Islam, لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. There is no God greater than Allah and Muhammad is his prophet. And this is what you see on the flag of Saudi Arabia. These are the words. These are the words you see hanging behind all the terrorists that behead people. Under that banner, the Muslims massacred Christians in Lebanon. They killed Hindus in India by the millions. Mm-hmm. They killed Armenians in Turkey, 2 million Armenians. They killed Copts in Egypt, Assyrians in Syria, and expelled over 900,000 Jews out of Arab land. All that happened by governments with the approval of Islamic governments, not just by a handful of radicals. Look at the Arabic world today. As the Jews were being expelled out of Libya, out of Jordan, out of Syria, out of Lebanon, as they were butchered and killed and burned and maimed, where were the governments of the governments? The Islamic governments did not agree with the massacring.
They agreed with it.
They agreed with it. Today, when we see all the bombing across the world, from 9/11 on, did we see any demonstrations in the Arabic moderate governments of the Arabic world?
Yes, we saw demonstrations. They were thrilled and happy that the bombings took place.
Exactly, Jimmy, exactly. They were dancing in the streets of Syria. They were dancing in the streets of Jordan. They were dancing in the streets of Gaza and the Palestinian territories. They were dancing in the streets of New Jersey. In the United States, in the mosques, yes, across from the World Trade Center, the Muslims were rejoicing. The echoes in our American prisons by the Muslims screaming Allahu Akbar when they heard the news of September 11th, they were singing and dancing in our American prisons. This is what the media does not want to speak about. If it is a handful of radicals, where are the governments of the Middle East organizing demonstrations and coming out and condemning what has been being done in the name of their religion?
They aren't there.
What about Jordan, the moderate country of Jordan, where we see King Abdullah and his wife Rania, who look like they just stepped out of the pages of Vogue magazine, right, who were educated in Britain? The only demonstrations we see is demonstrations to against the cartoon. Look what happened with the cartoon controversy. Look what happened when the Pope last year made the statement about quoting in an intellectual speech from the 7th century, a Byzantine emperor saying that Islam was spread through the sword and through forced conversions. Supermarkets were torched. A nun was killed in India. Thousands of Christians were injured. People were killed by demonstrations, and we saw this all over the Islamic nations. How come we do not see any of those people coming out and demonstrating by the thousands when people are killed in the Western world in the name of their religion?
They're in favor of it.
Exactly.
And you brought
actions
up.
Speak louder than words. We need to start watching what people are doing and not listen to empty verbiage by talking heads on Western TV stations,
right,
by Muslim,
right,
lobby group, right, selling us a lie about the peaceful religion of Islam.
And you brought out in your book, and of course anyone that keeps up with current events will know this, the Islamic children are taught from the moment of birth to hate the infidel and the Jew. We're the infidel, the Jew, we're great Satan, Israel is a little Satan. So it is born in them,
yes,
from the time that they can comprehend. Therefore, we will see pictures of little Arab children dressed up like terrorists with fake bombs upon them. They're literally being raised to be slaughtered for the sake of Islam, and that's what we're dealing with.
Exactly, and this is what we're dealing with, this is what we're seeing right now. But this has been going on for generations. This didn't start now.
Right,
I say,
right,
the Arab children are taught hatred towards the Jews from their mother's milk and towards the infidels. By the way, you know, we hear a lot, people in the West think that, you know, the Muslims only hate the Jews. No, in the Quran, anytime the Jews are mentioned, they are mentioned with the Christians. Mm-hmm. The Quran says, Al-Yahudu wa-Nasara, the Jews and the Christians. It's not only exclusively the Jews.
Right,
we
right.
are the infidels. My parents were refugees with me when I was 9 months old. They had to flee our town and go hide in another section of Lebanon because the Muslims were attacking our town. My home was blown up in 1975. I was 10 years old when my 911 happened to me, when the Muslims, in trying to take over my area of Lebanon, bombed my home, bringing it down and burying me under the rebel wounded. I ended up in a hospital for 2.5 months. And after many surgeries, I would be laying up in bed, hooked up to machines on both my arms with needles. And I would ask my parents, as an innocent child, suffering, laying in a bed with pain, why did they do this to us? And my father would tell me, because we are Christians, the Muslims consider us infidels and they want to kill us. So I learned as a Christian in the Middle East, since I was 10 years old, that I am wanted dead simply because I was born into the Christian faith. See, here in America, when Christians think about persecution, we look at persecution. If I take my Bible to work and people look at me the wrong way, yes, I'm being persecuted. Right. Yeah. That's our idea of persecution.
Right. Yeah.
You know, they're not allowing me. My neighbors complained because I put a nativity scene on my front yard on Christmas. That's our idea of persecution.
You're exactly right.
People in the rest of the world are being massacred, killed, beheaded, raped, buried alive simply because they're born into the Christian faith.
Okay, whenever all this was taking place in your city, before it got to your part, did you realize, and you and your parents, did you realize, Bridget, that you were going to be bombed at any point in time? It was just a matter of time that your house would be blown up, and or did you expect it not to get that far?
We expected it to come to South Lebanon because the whole country erupted in war. We had a lot of people fleeing from the towns that were massacred and coming and hiding in our town and telling us stories about what was happening, and we knew it was coming our way. My father even went to the banks in Beirut and withdrew almost all his money to bring us to the United States. He took everything in banknotes so we can flee. 2 days later, our home was blown up and all my father's money was burned to ashes and our lives were destroyed. My father was 70 years old, and not only he lost all his life savings, but he became deaf for the rest of his life.
Now, your mother, was she wounded in that time? She became gravely ill, didn't she?
My mother was the only one who was not wounded in the early bombing of our house. Only my father and I. My father became deaf and I was wounded. And
we ended up... Your mother was taken to a hospital in Israel.
But that was later.
That was 7 years later.
Oh, I see. Uh-huh.
That was after 7 years. Once they came to our area and they bombed our area, we became wounded. I became wounded. And then when we left the hospital...
You were buried under something, weren't you, Bridget?
Buried under the rubble of my home. They couldn't get me to a hospital for a day and a half after I was wounded. By the time they got me there, I was almost dead.
Well, how long did this conflict last? How many years during this time?
Well... It lasted for 7 years. When I left the hospital and we came back home, our home was no longer the home we
left. How did your family survive with everything you had destroyed? Your home destroyed, your finances gone?
We ended up living in a bomb shelter, underground, with no electricity, no water, and very little food. 7 years, from 1975 till 1982. And when we entered the bomb shelter, we thought, it's only going to be 2 weeks. It's only going to be maybe 2 months. This is going to be solved. America is going to come and save the Christians. France is going to come save the Christians. Britain is going to come save the Christians. We thought that the Christian countries of the world is going to see what's happening, the massacring that is being done to the Christians, and they're going to come do something. But no one paid attention. And we knew what our fate was going to be, because we were surrounded to be slaughtered. So few people from my town went to Israel and begged for help, because Israel was to our back. And we knew of supposedly the two enemies, the Muslims before us and the Jews behind us. We knew that if we go to the Jews are not going to slaughter us, because we had more shared values with them.
Of course, so you're saying that some of the elders in your area went to Israel thinking that it can't be worse than what we're experiencing.
Exactly. They went to Israel, flagged down an Israeli patrol, and said, we are not going to last 48 hours. You've got 48 hours and you'll have the Palestinians at your border, and us will be massacred. We need your help. We need each other's help. And within 48 hours, Israel started coming in the middle of the night.
What year was that? 80 what?
That was 1975, 76.
Oh, 75, 76.
Right. Okay. In that 7 years that you were in the bomb shelter in an area, how did you survive? How did the families there survive?
It was so difficult. It was barely existing. In order for us to get some food, my mother and I would crawl under the bombs outside of our bomb shelter. And we would dig out grass and dandelions and different vegetations that grew out around our bomb shelter. Even thorn. I learned how to peel thorn in my tender young fingers at age 10 and 11 and 12 so I can eat the stalk that grew inside of the thorn.
It was that critical.
That critical. In order to get some water, we would crawl under sniper's bullets to a nearby spring. In my hometown, it was called Marjayoun, the Valley of Spring. We had 8 springs in our town. And there was a spring 5 minutes from my home. And we would crawl under sniper's bullets to get some water. And every time before we left, we would say our last goodbyes, because we did not know if we're going to come back alive or dead.
Many of your friends were killed, I'm assuming.
By the time I was 20, I had buried most of my friends. I had only four friends alive.
One young man you were planning to marry.
One young man who was very dear and close to me. I remember he stopped by one day. In 1978, we had been fighting for 2 years. We had lost so many people, so many young Christian men, because, you know, we, the Christians, are very small to begin with. And without Israel's help, we didn't even survive 2 years. But Israel was only helping at night. Our Christian men were being trained and helping us during the day. And he stopped by, he said, "We heard on the radios that tonight we're going to be attacked, and I just want to wish you a merciful death because I don't think we're going to last." Mm. And he left. And I remember at age 13 years old, putting on my Sunday best, my Easter dress that my mother had sewed for me, because I wanted to look pretty when I'm dead, knowing that there would be no one to bury me. And we sat in the corner of our bomb shelter, and my parents and I held each other's hands, and we said the Lord's Prayer. And we had nothing but hope, and we had nothing but faith, and we knew there is nothing that can save us but the grace of God. And my parents said to me, "If they come to slaughter us tonight, you just run towards Israel and you never look back. We'll create a distraction. We lived a long life. We are old. You are young." You see, my parents were married for over 22 years. They could not have any children. My mother was 55 years old, and my father was 60 when I was born.
When you were born, how about that?
So I was truly the miracle in their lives. And they said, "You know, we lived a long life. You just saved your life." Thank God I didn't have to make that decision that night. And the only reason we survived is because that's when the Israeli military came in physically into Lebanon, set up checkpoints around our towns to protect us. Israel set up military bases and established the security zone.
When did you come to the place that you realized that what you had been told about Jews, what you had been told about Israel, had not been the truth, and you found out what they really were? How did that come about?
Well, by the time I was 11 years old, as a very, very young child, I knew that we are alive because of Israel, because Israel protected us and Israel came in the middle of the night. But it wasn't until 1982, when my mother was wounded and we ended up taking her to Israeli hospital for treatment, that I was able to get in touch with the Israelis one-on-one and get to know them.
How far was it from your home to the hospital in Israel, northern
Israel? It was an hour away from my home.
About 50 miles.
And my mother was wounded as Israel invaded Lebanon. And the only reason, by the way, Israel invaded Lebanon in 1982 was because Syria and Iran had gotten involved in the war in Lebanon. And Syria was supporting and propping the terrorist organization. And Syria was shelling Israel using Lebanese territories, calling it the Lebanese resistance. We had nothing to do with it. Now when I hear our president talking about the axis of evil, Syria and Iran meddling in the Lebanese government, I think to myself, where has America been for the last 30 years? The war in Lebanon was not a war between the Christian Lebanese and the Muslim Lebanese. It was a war between the Christian Lebanese trying to protect their democracy and the Muslims coming from all around the Arabic world, such as from Egypt and Syria and Saudi Arabia and Jordan, in order to create a base for radical Muslims to create a war to spread throughout the world.
Okay, I noticed you use the term radical Muslims. Why do you use that term?
I shouldn't use that term.
That's what I'm getting at.
That is a term we need to get out of our vocabulary.
That's what I'm getting at.
That term is sometimes used because people just tuning into the TV stations, and if you talk about Muslims in general, they're going to be offended because they haven't heard the beginning of the conversation.
Yeah, right.
But when we talk about Islam, when you read the Quran, you realize that the radicals who are killing themselves and blowing themselves up are not truly radical. That is mainstream Islam.
Yeah.
The radicals that we call radicals, who are blowing themselves up, are basically good practicing Muslims who are following the teachings of their Quran, their holy book, and doing exactly what the Prophet Muhammad, whom they consider al-insan al-kamil, the perfect man, had ordered them to do, and that is to kill the infidel, declare war on the infidel, behead them, terrorize them, smite over their necks, cut off their necks and smite them on their fingers and toes because they disobeyed Allah. These are the teachings of the Quran and the words of the Prophet Muhammad. So we need to stop looking at radicals and moderates and start looking at practicing Muslims and non-practicing Muslim. A practicing Muslim is a Muslim that goes to mosque every Friday, a Muslim that prays five times a day. A practicing Muslim is a Muslim that believes a woman is his property, according to the Quran, that He, as a practicing Muslim, has the right to kill his wife, rape his wife, beat his wife, and do the same thing to his daughters and every female member of the family.
Okay, tell us a little bit about, how do you pronounce it, Sharia law? Sharia law?
Sharia law.
Okay.
And Sharia law is basically what the Quran teaches, because in Quran is a totalitarian ideology. There is no difference and no separation between the church or the mosque and state. The state is the mosque and the mosque is the state. There is no separation.
Right.
And Sharia law, Islam orders, according to the Quran, that all Muslims must live by the teachings of the Quran. And these are the teachings of the Quran. And this is why in Islamic societies, women have no right. Islam is not compatible with democracy. A non-practicing Muslim, or what we would call a moderate Muslim, is a Muslim who does not believe the Quran literally, is a Muslim who does not believe that he has a right to rape or kill his wife or subjugate his wife.
Well, there are many of them like that. Many Muslims that do not subscribe to the murder, the rape, the raping, the killing, the slaughter, the bloodletting, and so forth.
Yes, there are. There are a lot of Muslims that are like that. There are a lot of Muslims in the West who respect the West.
Are they making themselves heard?
No, they're not making themselves heard. And those who are making themselves heard, the few who are writing books, who are speaking about it, are basically your average citizens who are not getting support from any Islamic organization and who are not even getting support from our Western media, because when they come out and speak against Muslims and call a spade and call it by its name, Islam, they are called Islamophobes by our Islamic media on our college campuses, and they are being shunned. So those we need to support to sound the alarms basically are being suppressed, are being silenced in the name of multiculturalism and tolerance.
Do these individuals, are they beginning, these so-called moderate Muslims, are they beginning to get the idea, as one article was printed in Newsweek magazine, and I can't pronounce the man's name who printed it, but he was a Muslim. He said, it might be time for us to look at our religion. Something is wrong with our religion. And I'm wondering, are there many moderates that are beginning to think through their religion? Because everything they do is based, as you said, on the Quran. Am I right?
Yes.
That's their foundation. That's everything that they do.
That's the anchor.
But when you look at the Quran, I haven't studied it but a tiny bit, but it advocates all the things that we're discussing here, murder, slaughter, torture, terrorism. It all comes from the Quran. Am I correct?
Correct. And it comes from the Quran, and the Pentagon did a study last year. And this is out of the Pentagon. And they concluded that all the terrorist attacks and what is driving terrorism around the world right now is basically the holy book of the Quran. Now, this study is controversial.
But they don't dare say anything about it.
You didn't hear the media report about it. I mean, this is a Pentagon report. This is a Pentagon study. So because they are dealing with terrorists, they are capturing it, they are interrogating them. Look at all the terrorists we are capturing. They are screaming Allahu Akbar before they kill themselves. They are doing it for the sake of Allah. Our enemy is not mincing words. They are not politically correct. They are so bold in their faith. They are so bold in their belief, and they're telling us exactly what they're doing and why and what's the base for them doing it. We are not listening because we believe all religions are good. All religions are not good.
No, they're not.
Christianity, we had some very nasty verses in our Old Testament, if you read our Bible. However, and a lot of ugly things have been done in the name of Christianity. However, we as Jews and Christians have reformed our religion. We realize that in the 21st century, we are not going to go behead people, kill people, because we believe we need to talk to people. We Christians, and you as an evangelist, will be the first person to condemn anybody who would strap bombs on their bodies,
right,
Jim, and go out and blow a mosque.
Right, right.
Because we as Christians do not agree with killing and torturing and raping.
And we believe that Muslims, we should pray for them.
That's right.
And if we have contact with them, they should be treated kindly and graciously.
Absolutely.
But we should also at the same time know the truth about what Islam really is.
Here's what I say. Be as kind as dove and as wise as serpents.
We must be
kind to our brothers, no matter who they are, from what religion they come from. We must be kind to them. But let's not confuse being kind with being wise. You can be wise, you can be suspicious, you can be vigilant, but you can still be kind.
We've got just a few minutes left here. And you're constantly speaking all over the world, really, am I right?
Correct.
And all the way from the President of the United States to the Parliament in Great Britain to heads of state and other places, plus churches, plus wherever. I saw you the other day addressing some part of the military college.
The Joint Forces Command.
Right, right. And it was interesting, the young man who stood up and said he had served in the Army for I don't know how many years, but was a Muslim. Did you remember that, I'm sure?
Actually, thank you for bringing that up, because that person that stood up and asked that question in an American military uniform with an American flag on his arm was actually a Saudi commander on an exchange program in our government. This is what he did not say on camera on C-SPAN for the public who are watching to hear. And he was speaking about how he was a moderate Muslim and a practicing Muslim, but he forgot to mention, I'm a Saudi raised on Wahhabism, and I'm on an exchange program with your government so we can learn how you guys do tactical combat for terrorism. And I believe it is a sin, it is a crime to allow Saudi generals to be in our training in our government, especially in high sensitive positions.
Exactly. Yes.
And to add insult to injury, dress in our uniforms, because when that man stood on C-SPAN and asked that question, you would think he's your next door Muslim neighbor who's a loving American, practicing American, patriotic American serving our country.
I thought he was. I thought he was a member of our armed forces. You see, nobody said anything about that. And
exactly.
I noticed that did you know that before or after?
I knew that before. Actually, the C-SPAN session that C-SPAN aired was the question-answer session at the end of the day.
I
had training sessions with these commanders, about 80 of them in the first session for 2 hours.
What was their reaction to you?
Most of them, they understand the problem, they are very aware of the problem, and of course I was detailing the fact in my previous two-hour detailed session, the involvement, the penetration of Saudi Arabia into our government, into our university systems, financing the mosques and supporting cells within our country to perpetrate terrorism attacks in our country and the world, and the Saudi financing to terrorism. This guy was sitting in the audience, livid with my statements. The American commanders loved what I was saying. Of course, with their position in a uniform, they cannot say anything.
Right,
they have to be politically correct.
Right.
Actually, to the point that the commander who invited me had to change the subject a little bit, and he says, well, we're talking a lot about Saudi Arabia. Why don't we just talk about other countries like Indonesia? He felt so concerned that I have blown the whistle with Saudis sitting in the crowd.
I know we're coming to an end. She summed it up in her book, the attitude of the Americans that they need to understand is a statement that's prevalent in all of Islam. Saturday is coming and then Sunday.
Exactly.
Yeah.
In Islam, every child and every Christian in the Middle East are raised with this sentence, أَوَّلًا يَأْتِي السَّبْتُ وَبَعْدُهُ الْأَحَدُ. First comes Saturday, then comes Sunday. First we kill the Jews,
Saturday.
Then we come for the Christians.
Sunday.
What starts with the Jews never ends with the Jews. And the world now is seeing this, because the world turned a blind eye to evil. When Jewish blood was being shed on the streets of Tel Aviv and Jerusalem, nobody really gave a darn. Who cares about what happens in Israel? It doesn't affect us. But what we are seeing today is that the same enemy that Israel's been fighting for over 55 years is the enemy that now the whole world is fighting.
Yeah,
and
right.
because we turned a blind eye to that evil back there, now this evil has come to our shores and is fighting us here.
I want to deal with we mentioned the Saudis, and that is if you want to. Deal with the manner in which the Saudi government concerning our oil billions are buying their way into our corporations, into our media, into our universities, and thereby being able to persuade in directions that they so desire due to their influx of oil money, incidentally, which came from the taxpayers of this country.
Yes.
I want to look at political correctness as well. And thirdly, I want to look at next week at, from your vast experience, what do you think that this nation should do? Now, my contention is, you know, will we do it? I'm afraid that we'll continue to be not Uncle Sam, but rather Uncle Sap. And that's pretty well what we are, mostly. But what you feel like the nation should do, and what steps we ought to take as it regards this scourge, because it's quite possible now, And my contention is that, well, let me say this first, that an atomic bomb, we have atomic bombs now that are about the size of a softball. It could take out New York City, Washington, D.C., any major city, hundreds of thousands of casualties. Will it take that to wake this nation up to the evils of the religion of Islam? Or the Muslims, are they making such headway without doing that due to their encroachment into this nation by other means that they're thinking it's not much point in us doing it, or does their religion demand that they steal and kill and destroy? This particular situation, as a child and then growing up in it, she was not Muslim. She was born in Lebanon, raised there, and raised as a Christian, to be frank with you. But her whole world was surrounded by the religion of Islam. Her book, entitled Because They Hate, is, I think, personally, the most informative book that you could ever read as it regards an understanding of the religion of Islam, what it's all about, and what is taking place in this country today, and the danger that our country is facing. The danger that our country is facing. I made the statement last week, I'll make it again now. I feel like this great United States, the land of the brave, the home of the free, is in greater danger, threatened now to a greater degree than ever before in our history. And you might ask, how could that be, considering the past, the Cold War, Pearl Harbor, and so forth? For this reason, it's perfectly possible now for an atomic bomb the size of a softball to be taken in a suitcase or even a handbag almost and detonated in New York City, Washington, D.C., Denver, Colorado, Los Angeles, Chicago, wherever, with hundreds of thousands of casualties. And there are millions of individuals in the religion of Islam who want to do just that. And will it take that to wake us up? That's the reason I'm saying that our nation is in greater danger today, I believe, than it's ever been before in its history. Let's have a word of prayer as we begin today. Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you. Thank you for our guest who jeopardizes her life every single hour of every single day by the stand that she has taken and is taking. I would pray, Lord, that you would watch over her, protect her. This nation and the world needs her voice. They need her experience. And I'm asking for that divine protection, Lord, and that the programming last week and this week will help to awaken people who need to be awakened to the danger that's in our midst. And I'll ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. I want to make it clear as we begin today, we do not hate Muslims, not at all. We love Muslims as we love everybody. Anyone who is a genuine Christian, a Bible Christian, loves everybody. But I'll say something we do hate. We do hate that which steals and kills and destroys. Jesus loved the sinner, but he hated the sin because he knew what the sin would do in the hearts and lives of individuals. And we love the Muslim. We pray for them. And I would encourage you to pray for them as well. And if you happen to have the occasion to have Muslims as your acquaintances or whatever the case, you as a Christian would be kind and gracious to them as you ought to be. But at the same time, we must be alerted to the truth, not only for the sake of our nation and the world, but for the sake of Muslims also. Bridget, I want to start this program today by dealing with the proposed or the effort made for the gasoline bombs in London and Glasgow, Scotland, I think, as well, which would have done what, which would have killed an awful lot of people had the perpetrators been successful in what they were attempting to do. I looked at our newsmen who were relating this incident, because it was, of course, on all the news here in this nation and should have been. They were perplexed. They were stating, "We do not understand." These individuals who were the perpetrators of this effort, which would have killed hundreds of innocent people had it been successful, were doctors. They were, some of them were vastly intelligent according to their IQs. How in the world, why in the world would they do such a thing? Because the idea in this nation has been, well, these people have issues that are doing these things. And you know, these mean old Americans, you know, we, whatever bad that happens to us, or even those in England, we are due that. Because these people have been deprived, they've been set up on, they've been hurt, and they have been atrocities committed against them. What, I don't know, but at any rate, but these are professional people. They are educated. They are medical doctors, and there's very little education you can get higher than a medical doctor. How could they do such a thing? I looked at the perplexity on their faces. What they did not know nor understand was that it's got nothing to do with you were being deprived as a Palestinian in a refugee camp or something of that nature. All of those things may play a tiny part, but only a tiny part. But it's the religion of Islam that is back of this thing. And that's why that these medical doctors planned and made every attempt to carry out what they did. Would you address that, please?
Yes, well, we are finding out, and the world, we already knew that, but the mainstream media can no longer ignore the fact that we are fighting an ideology. An ideology that can take a doctor who's supposed to save lives, it can take a doctor to strap bombs on his body and go to kill thousands. We are fighting an ideology that is able to alter human instinct and take a mother and basically make her strap suicide belt on her own child and send him out to blow himself up, not only kill himself, but kill other children in the name of religion. This is the fact that the West has to face, that this war we are fighting comes out of one book called the Holy Quran and the religion of Islam.
In other words, it affects all alike, whether they are intellectuals, educated, poverty-stricken, it makes no difference.
It makes no difference. See, the leftists in this country and in the West and the mainstream media used to say, oh, if we just give them a little bit more money, you know, if they just are rich, if, because we in the West judge everything according to, we are such a materialistic society,
right,
that we
right.
think if you have the big house, if you drive the Mercedes, if you have the money yeah. in the bank, what more could you want? I mean, this is the life.
Yeah.
We have lost the spiritual connection in the United States.
That's
and in
right.
the West in general.
Yeah. Yeah.
However, in the Islamic world, what bonds all these people together is basically not money, but their faith in Allah and what the Quran tells them to do.
In other words, they are setting out to, number one, kill the infidel, because they look at America and even England as nations which are stopping them from destroying Israel. Is that right?
Exactly. Exactly. And not only stopping them from destroying Israel.
And they want to evangelize the world with Islam.
Exactly. They want to turn the whole world into Islam. I mean, the last press release that we had from al-Zawahiri, the second man in charge of al-Qaeda, he said, we want to establish an Islamic Khalifa beginning in Iraq and spreading through Europe and then throughout the world. They're telling us exactly what they want to do.
Do they have a chance of doing that?
Yes, they do have a chance of doing that if we do not stop them, if we do not wake up now. Now we have a chance in waking up and stopping them. Look at it this way. America is at stage 2 cancer. Europe is at stage 3 cancer. Mm-hmm. At stage 2 cancer, you can still check yourself into the hospital, have surgery, get the cancer cells out of your body, go through chemotherapy, and then you have a chance of survival. If you wait too long until the cancer is at stage 4,
right.
even if you wake up then and you decide to have surgery, it's already too late.
You're terminal.
So what we're seeing right now is these radical, if we want to call them radical Islamists, the doctors who decide to blow themselves up for the sake of those leftists who may be watching, what we are seeing is they are infiltrating our society on every level, and they are using everything in their power, such as using doctors and intellectuals, or what people in the West perceive as intellectuals and smart people, basically because we put our guards down to these people to commit terrorist attacks. The problem is so severe that now we must open our eyes and we must realize that poverty has nothing to do with it. It is ideology. What we also need to pay attention to is they are coming to our countries. They are trying to use everything in their power to enter our country legally or illegally. Let's remember that two of these doctors that are now imprisoned because of the attack in Britain tried to come to the United States. Mm-hmm. They applied to be accepted in a hospital in Philadelphia.
And why were they wanting to come to this country?
They wanted to come to this country to do exactly
there
here what
go.
They tried
there
to do in England,
yeah.
and that is kill infidels, regardless of their Jews. They want to kill Christians and Jews and Buddhists and atheists and everybody else, anybody who's a non-Muslim.
And, you know, I'm glad you brought that up, because the fact is the American public needs to understand that they are killing people of all faiths around the world.
Exactly. Yeah. Of all faith. And you know, we in this country so sadly put everything, well, I'm a Democrat and you're a Republican, and you know, I'm a Democrat, you know, they're going to like me because I'm on their side. What we are seeing is the terrorism issue is not a Republican issue, it's not a Democratic issue. It's an American issue.
Right.
It's not a Buddhist issue, it's not a born-again Christian issue. It's not
right.
a right-wing
right.
issue, it's
right.
not a left issue.
Right.
It's an American issue. I don't see any of the beheaders that beheaded Daniel Pearl or Nick Berg or the other 35 hostages in Iraq stop for 1 second and ask them, are you a Democrat or are you a Republican?
Right. Right.
Are you a born-again
yeah.
Christian
yeah.
or are you an atheist? They beheaded them because they were Americans, regardless of their religion, regardless of their sect, regardless of their political affiliation. They were Westerners, period. And this is what America needs to wake up to.
What about the cell groups that you say in your book, and you list some of the places that there are organized cell groups, which we'll use the term radical, with intentions of causing harm to this nation, and that they are fomenting plans constantly to wreak havoc in this country. Those cells are here now in this country?
Those cells are here now, have been here now for the last 10 years. We have known about their existence here for the last 10 years, and they are plotting our destruction as we speak. And I'll give you examples. For example, you hear a lot of Hamas and Hezbollah on the news. You know, it's always on the news, there is war. People think, that's 8,000 miles away problem. It doesn't affect me. You know, they're not here. We think that Al-Qaeda is our problem here.
Mm-hmm.
Of all the terrorist organizations that have set up shop on American soil, the top three are Al-Qaeda, Islamic Jihad, and Hamas. Hamas, not Al-Qaeda. Hamas has the largest infrastructure on American soil. Hamas has cells in over 40 states in the United States.
That's what just took over the Gaza Strip.
That's what just took over the Gaza Strip. They're here. They have cells in over 40 states in the United
States.
In
this country.
In this country. In my book, I even detail the cities and the states where they are in. They have cells in New York City, in Boston, in Massachusetts, in New York, in Washington, D.C., in Laurel, Maryland, in Springfield, Virginia, in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, in Boca Raton, in Orlando, in Cincinnati, in
Nashville.
Ohio, Nashville, Raleigh, North Carolina, and the list, Colorado, Denver, Tucson, Texas.
Do our authorities know about these cells? I'm sure they do.
They know about these cells. These cells, Hamas, and I'm going to use for example, talks in their charter about destroying terrorists, what they consider terrorists in our country. And they consider terrorists the Lions Clubs, the Rotary Clubs, the Kiwanis and the likes, and the Freemasons. Now, how many people watching who are members of the Lions Clubs and the Rotary Clubs who wake up in the morning to go to their meetings, to raise money, to do good in their community, know that they are mentioned in the Hamas charter, the Hamas, the largest terrorist organization on our soil? The problem is not only Hamas. The problem is Hezbollah. Hezbollah has 11 cells in America. They have cells. Do you know, and I'm going to use the state of Texas as an example, because, you know, when we think of Texas, that's like yeehaw land. You cannot get any more Americana than Texas.
That's right.
Do you know that in Texas alone, they have 2,500 Hezbollah members? Texas, not Dearbornistan, Michigan, where you expect them.
Who are these individuals who are members of Hezbollah or whoever, whatever? Who are they? Are they Americans? Are they transplanted Arabs over here? Who are they?
Both. They are American citizens born and raised here. They are illegal aliens who've been smuggled through the Mexican border. What the problem we have now with the border, and this is why it is so important that we shut the border down, we close our borders, is the terrorists have figured out a way to work with the gangs in smuggling terrorists into the country. Al-Qaeda is working with the MS-13 gang, the notorious terrorist gang, in smuggling terrorists into the country. Al-Qaeda is paying the MS-13 gang between $25,000 to $50,000 per terrorist to be smuggled into the country.
Right.
Hezbollah is doing the same thing. We suspect that thousands have been smuggled into the country via the Mexican border.
And we saw that come to life just a couple of months ago with this attempted attack on a military base. And when they tracked us down, many of them came into this country illegally through the Mexican border.
Exactly. What is happening is the gang and the drug cartels could care less now about smuggling Mexicans. I mean, that is a major problem. But Mexicans don't pay like terrorists. So you have terrorists paying between $25,000 and $50,000. And that's now the drug deals, that's the business that's coming through the border. They are coming into our country, and they are directly going to the major cities in the United States where there is a large Islamic concentration, like Miami, Washington, D.C., New York and New Jersey, Dearborn, Michigan, L.A., Texas, Houston. By the way, do you know that in Houston alone, they have 65 mosques in Houston? The city of Houston.
No, I didn't know that.
They are coming here.
How many mosques are in the United States as a whole right now?
We expect right now about 2,000. 300 madrasas in the United States. Madrasas. Madrasas are radical Islamic schools that brainwash children that we all infidel need to be dead. They are basically teaching them Sharia law and the Quran. When you hear the word madrasa, you hear it, you think, you know, Pakistan, Indonesia. But you don't think madrasas in the United States. On our website, AmericanCongressForTruth.org, we post a petition and we quote what they're teaching in those madrasas. They are teaching, we quote the book, we take paragraphs out of the book, they are teaching that Christian and Jews are apes and pigs because they are cursed by Allah. They are teaching if there is a Jew behind the tree, go and kill him.
And that's not in the Gaza Strip, that's here.
That's here. In the United States, on American soil.
Once again, is it acceptable by the authorities that they know about this, I'm assuming?
Here's the problem. Freedom of religion. Our enemy is using our laws against us, and political correctness is killing us. Political correctness needs to be thrown in the garbage where it belongs. It is the devil, it is evil, and it does not belong in our society.
Right.
We must
right.
stop political correctness
right.
now
right.
and start
right.
calling a spade a spade.
Right.
The problem is, because of political correctness, it is shackles around our ankles that is preventing us from doing something about the hate education happening in the mosques. We need to change the laws. We need to start putting pressure on our elected officials to change the laws and to start monitoring mosques. What they're teaching in mosques, see, all this nurturing of terrorist mentality is happening in the mosques in the United mm-hmm. States. While we in our churches preach love, preach forgiveness, treat your neighbor the way you want to be treated, judge not others lest you be judged, love others, I mean, do not kill, do not steal, do not lie. These are our commandments. This is what we teach our children. In Islam, it is the opposite. In my book, I detail a study about what they're teaching in mosques in the United States. What's happening is most of the mosques in the United States and the world are supported by the government of Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
Because of the oil money.
Right.
We pump the gas and they pump poison all throughout the world using our money through
right.
the oil wealth,
right.
brainwashing
right.
millions around the world.
All right. How much money is pouring into for instance, you know, the candidates for the highest office in the world are traveling all over this nation. How much money is sneaking in from Saudi Arabia as it regards this coming election? I mean, it's just a guess. Nobody probably knows.
Nobody knows. They are, you know, it's especially in a political campaign, that is done very creatively. But we know we have lobby group in the United States, for example, like CARE, the Council on American Islamic Relations, which is funded from money coming from the Gulf, from Saudi Arabia, and from those rich Arab sheikhs. And CARE is using its money in the United States to lobby our elected official and fund their campaigns. For example, Keith Ellison, the Muslim who was elected to Congress in Minnesota. And his victory party, shouts of Allahu Akbar ringed through the room. Now, this should send shivers down the spines of every American.
Exactly.
Those are the words that terrorists who are committing suicide attacks and beheading Americans scream Allahu Akbar as they're slitting Americans' throats or as they're flying airplanes into skyscrapers.
Did he have a predominantly Muslim community that voted him in, or were some of our people so stupid?
Democrats. Yes, some of our people are very ignorant that they voted him in, and a lot of Muslim constituency in his area voted him in. See, what's happening also is the Democrats in our country want to appear so tolerant that they're overcompensating. You had Jewish people on Keith Ellison's campaign running his campaign.
That's hard to believe. Because they're
Jewish, they overcompensate because they wanted to appear more tolerant and loving. This is the problem we have in our country right now, is we must understand that not all Muslims are terrorists, but we must understand Islam's and the law of Islam. And that is, in Islam, an elected official, if he is a practicing Muslim, like Keith Ellison is, for example, and wanted to swear on the Quran in particular, goes to show you how practicing Muslim he is. In Islam, if you are a loyal Muslim, your loyalty is to Islam first,
right?
Not to your country. Not
right,
to your family,
right,
not
right,
to your
right,
own right. flesh and blood. So if America is faced with war, and this elected official has to choose between protecting Americans and America's interest and protecting Islam, this elected official, as a Muslim, will have to choose to protect Islam against the United
now,
States.
You made the statement in your book that they interviewed quite a number of young people who were Muslims, and they gave them particular scenarios. Would you defend America against so-and-so who is a Muslim? Hussein was one of them, Saddam.
Right.
And I think you said in your book, and I'm trying to pull it up in my memory, something like 60-something percent said,
right,
no, they would not fight against Saddam.
That's right. That's
no matter
right.
what he did to America. Because
80%.
80%
said that they will not fight with the United States against any Arabic country in the Middle East.
Okay, the chaplains, go ahead.
What is even more interesting is this study that was just done now, a couple months ago, where the Pew Report polled Muslim Americans in America who are Muslim citizens and asked them if they support suicide bombing. So what martyrdom operations we're talking now. In the United States, 26% today, in 2007, 26% of Muslim Americans who hold American citizenship believe and support suicide operations. That means they believe and support operations committed by Muhammad Atas and people like that, because they believe under certain circumstances that is justified.
I believe that you in essence, you didn't say it, but you alluded to it, that England is further down this road than we are here in America right now. I said a stage two, they're stage
That's
almost
right.
four in England.
That's right.
They've gotten to the place to where that it's now, you know, law is in jeopardy there in favor of Islamic law. Is that correct?
Correct. They are changing the laws in the schools. They are changing the laws in the government. A survey was done in Britain a few months ago where they asked Muslims in Britain, British Muslims, where their loyalty lies, if they would support Sharia law. 60% of British Muslims said they would much rather live under Sharia law than under British law. Now, these are British citizens living and enjoying the freedom and democracy of the West. See, we in the West right now are saying, if we can just bring democracy to the Middle East, if we can just bring democracy to Islamic countries, they're going to love our way of life.
Why is it that the American people do not really seem to know and understand what the religion of Islam is really like? That they don't understand how that women are treated as property, pretty much. They don't understand the murder, the bloodshed, the demand that the whole world be taken over for Islam, which would throw the world into a dark ages of unprecedented proportion. I heard the other day over the news, and I can't quote the exact numbers, and I don't have the source, but they said in the last 10 years that over 100 Nobel Prizes, some of them peace, some of them science, some of them whatever the case, have been granted to Israelis or Jews around the world. Muslims, two.
Yeah.
You understand?
And
what
one
I'm
of
saying?
Them was to Yasser Arafat.
It was.
Now, that's the greatest theorist in the world.
That's right.
That's when I lost my respect to the Nobel Prize.
Yeah, you're exactly
right.
That's
when the Nobel Prize became nothing worthy of respect, when they gathered together and awarded to one of the man, to a man who's
terrorist.
A terrorist leader who has more blood on his hands than any of other leaders we know in our lifetime. But you know, Jimmy, the problem is lack of education. Americans who are educated on the facts, who are studying Islam, are realizing and understanding that the problem is Islam. Those who are watching the news are understanding. The problem now is we have people who would much rather watch American Idol, Survivor, reality television.
Yeah.
We need to pull them away from that and educate them, because I believe in the American public. I believe if Americans are informed, they will do something about it. Just like the people that watch the doctors want to become a part of a suicide killing machine in Britain.
Yeah.
Now, these people all of a sudden are asking, you know, it is not only the poor. It is the wealthy. Maybe we need to reconsider. Maybe we need to look at Islam. And you're seeing more of that. And actually, the terrorists are bringing it about by their actions.
In your travels all over this nation and around the world, really, but especially this nation.
And what we're also doing, Jimmy, to educate the American public in particular, our organization, AmericanCongressForTruth.org, was founded specifically to mobilize Americans, educate them, empower them, inform them as to how they can become a voice affecting their community and our nation. I formed the organization because I realized not only we need to educate, which we do, we send people emails every day or every other day, educating them about issues, what's happening in our country, but we also show them when there's a bill being voted on the floor or when there's a bill about to come out, we immediately send an email and say, this bill about our national security is about to be voted on. Call your elected officials. People need to be given the tools to be involved. And I urge everyone watching to go to our website, AmericanCongressForTruth.org, and sign up to receive our emails and action alerts so they can be informed. Right now, I ask for those who are watching to pray for us. We just hired an executive director to set up chapters nationwide to mobilize patriotic Americans, to have them become the voice who's going to change our nation. We can no longer sit and wait on our elected officials sitting in Washington, D.C., being influenced by lobbyists to serve us. We must wake up and take things into our own hands to put the pressure on our elected officials to make them act.
Bridget, you know, I've seen you on the news several times in the last year, and I've watched very interestingly. What is your response to these ABC, NBC, CBS, all of the networks, when you share this story? The reaction I get from the people doing the interviews is, well, you're just one little segment over here. In other words, I get the opinion outside of Fox News that they really don't believe what you're saying.
Well, you are correct to a point. When we started speaking out 5 years ago, when I would say, like I detail in my book, how the doctors, the lawyers, our Muslim neighbors in Lebanon turned against us, people used to look at me and say, well, maybe she's exaggerating. But as this war on terror develops, and by the way, let's call it the war on Islamofascism, one of the things that aggravate me greatly about our president, and I think he failed our citizens by not calling a spade, by not calling this war of what it is.
Right,
this
right,
war yeah. is a war by Islam against the rest of the world. If you take Islam out of the war on terror, we wouldn't have a war on terror.
Right.
And in the last few years, when we would talk about how our, you know, it's an ideology, people did not want to believe it. But as this war develops on Islamofascism, and when we hear about a ring of doctors in England wanting to blow up the same hospitals that they practiced in, then people have to sit back and say, you know, we've heard that before. We've heard it from those people before. We have been warned. It's no news. It's nothing new. We have said that before. And finally, we are seeing our voice resonate among others. Slowly but surely, it's coming.
Do you feel that you are making some headway, that some people are, in essence, you've pretty well answered it, but I want to dig into it a little deeper. Do you meet in your addresses wherever you go, do you meet much hostility?
Oh, yes. What a question. Absolutely. And places I have to speak, I just spoke at a church in California. The FBI called the church and said, you need to beef up security because there are a lot of death threats, and you need to make sure, if you want to have speakers like this, you need to have security. We had over 12 undercover guards fully armed in the church, in an American church in the United States, for someone like me to speak.
Okay,
and that's in a church.
That's different than what I'm talking about, though. Like, you speak at a lot of colleges.
Oh, yes.
Now, I happen to believe that the state of our universities is sad, to be frank with you, at a lot of the fault or all that's going on there. Do you get much opposition? They don't believe what you say, or they don't agree with what you say, or they just don't care. They would rather have Islam than they would what they have now. Do you have that?
Oh, in this area, colleges are very dangerous to any conservative speaker. First of all, they don't even want us on campus. If you are a liberal speaker who bashes America, who badmouths America, badmouths Israel, you're welcomed with the red carpet laid out for you as a speaker. The college university allows the student to sponsor you. They even fund your speaking engagement. When conservative students want to bring in conservative speakers like me and others, you cannot believe the red tape. We're not allowed in, and when we are allowed, we have to have extreme security with us, bodyguards, office security, the FBI gets involved, the Department of Homeland Security gets involved, and here is why. Because our universities have been infiltrated to such a level by the Muslims on the universities that it is those who are creating the problem. Do you realize that on American colleges today, the Muslim Student Association has more chapters on American college campuses than the Democrat and the Republicans combined? The Muslims group, more than the Democrats and the Republicans. They are funded by the government of Saudi Arabia, and what has been happening in the last 16 years, Saudi Arabia has been able to exploit a program set up by our government called the Title VI program. And that program was set up for, after World War II, for our students to be educated about different cultures, different languages, so they may be an asset to our government. What's happening is Saudi Arabia is setting up Middle East science departments and political science departments and financing them and appointing Arab professors who are anti-America, anti-our policy, anti-Israel, and this is why we're seeing the brainwashing in general on all our college campuses, from the Ivy League to the community colleges, to hating America, brainwashing our children to thinking that we are the problem because we are rich and the poor Muslims who are suffering, that's why they're turning to suicide bombing. They're literally feeding our kids lies and brainwashing them.
I've preached all over Africa, and I remember them telling me one day that they would send their brightest students to the university. If they sent them to the university in Moscow, they came back confirmed capitalist. If they sent them to the universities here in the States, they came back confirmed communist.
Wow.
Now, you think of that.
Wow. Wow.
And now, in your, we've touched on it here and there, but what is your advice, your word, your statement to the people of the United States? What should we do about this problem? What steps should we be taking? What should be the activity of the common, not common, but the American citizen?
Get involved. Learn.
What do you mean
get
by
involved.
Getting involved?
And what I mean by that is join organizations like ours. American Congress for Truth, ACT, was founded as an activist organization to mobilize and inform American citizens how they can make a difference.
You're saying pressure applied to congressmen, to senators, still, carry some weight.
Oh, absolutely. And this is why I tell people you must sign up to receive our free emails and action alerts. And I'll give you an example. I talk to people all the time, and I ask them, to elected officials, how many people do you need to hear from to make an issue your top priority where you can pass a bill about it? You will be surprised. 40 to 50 people. That's it. You know, people sometimes, the average American thinks, what is my voice going to count? I am one, my congressman needs to hear from 50,000 people before they make a difference. No, it's 40 to 50 people, and here is why. Because they believe that if they hear from one person, he or she are representing 1,000 voters.
That's it.
And that translates to 40 to 50,000 voters on election day.
Right.
That can make or break an election. We give tips to people on how they can get involved. For example, if you know there is a mosque in your community or an Islamic institution and you suspect it suspicious activity, go down to your local city hall. Find out who owns the deed to that mosque. Is it a Saudi foundation? Is it some Arab sheikhs outside of the United States? Write their names down. Come home. Call your local FBI office. It's a free call. Turn the names to them. We are the eyes and ears of our government. The FBI can start monitoring the mosques. For example, if you are over the age of 55 years old, do you know that in America today, every senior citizen over the age of 55 years old can sign up to attend the university course free of charge? We want to mobilize senior citizens to sign up at the Middle East Science Department or Political Science Department just to monitor the professors. Because somebody who is mature, who's 55 years old, is there to stand up and challenge the professor and tell the truth so the other 30 students in the class can hear an opposing point of view other than the lies that the professor is saying.
What about immigration?
Immigration. We need to be informed about why we need to close the Mexican border. And this is why it is so important for people to call their elected officials, which we make it available on our website. You click on Contact Congress, you type in your zip code, we give you your elected official, congressman and senator, their names, their telephone numbers, their addresses, so you can call them and you can express your point of view about where you stand on the immigration. And not only immigration. Different states have different needs. There are laws presented in one state that may not be in another. And this is why it's important to call your elected official and express your point of view about immigration, about border control, about visa control. Do you know now that we're giving visas to Arab students, specifically from Saudi Arabia in particular, to come in large volumes to our country to sign up and study? We want to control those visas. Do you know that we have 30,000 students in America today from Arabic Muslim hostile countries who are studying here? Some of them are studying nuclear power and development. If we do not want them to develop nuclear power, why are we teaching them?
Right. Okay, let me ask, will it ever come to the place? I can't see that it will, but I'll ask it anyway. That we just simply will not allow a Muslim to immigrate to this country. Could it get that bad?
It will get that bad only after a nuclear bomb or a biological bomb goes off in a major city in the United States and we lose 10 to 12 million people.
That's what I
am so afraid that this is what's going to take to wake up America. But this is why we're doing everything we can. And I thank you for inviting me on your show and sharing this vital message with millions of viewers who are watching today. You are a huge part of the solution, Jimmy, that will prevent, hopefully, a nuclear bomb going off in the United States, for helping me come and give my message and urge people to get involved with us, get involved in the chapters we're about to develop, sign up to receive our emails, so together as Americans, we can work up and network and mobilize our country before a major incident can happen.
Her emails are excellent. I want you to know that. I read them. They come here, and they're worth reading. We get tons of emails. That's not really worth your time, but this young lady, what she puts out is worth reading.
And her website is very, very informative on the issues of what we're talking. And I go to it not every day, but just about every week, and it helps keep me informed.
Do you think America will wake up? Do you think that we will come to our senses and will take the necessary steps to protect ourselves?
I think we will. I think with us mobilizing the nation and waking up the grassroots. See, what we're trying to do right now is basically mobilize the largest grassroots this nation has ever seen. This is what ACT, American Congress for Truth, is doing. And I think we will be able to do that because I believe in the heart and soul of America. Look at this last election. 3 million more people voted for Bush. The issue was terrorism.
You're right.
Because at this point, the country, even though we hear, you know, CNN and the leftist talking heads who believe that, you know, terrorism is a concoction of the Bush administration, what they are realizing now, especially after what happened in London, terrorism is all over the world threatening Western civilization, regardless what country you live in, Australia, Canada, Britain.
Right.
It's a major issue. And I believe the terrorism issue is so near and dear to the hearts of Americans, far more than any other issue. And I believe America will rise up. We may have an attack that will help us rise up even faster, but we will rise up and we will defeat Islamofascism.
For our closing minutes, Iran.
Closing. such a huge subject. Iran is the greatest threat. We will go to war with Iran. Even if we do not initiate it, we will be dragged into it. Because Iran is driven by a messianic vision to bring about the Islamic Messiah, the Mahdi. And this is what's driving their nuclear program. Iran will have a nuclear bomb in less than a year. Iran will attack Israel. Iran will create a problem where the whole world will be dragged into war, just like we did with Hitler.
Benjamin Netanyahu just the other day stated that when asked the question, if America does not step in, will Israel take the initiative regarding Iran? He sat there for a few moments and said nothing. I had the occasion to speak with him on, not speak with him, but I was one of the speakers in a Jewish Congress in Washington some years ago. He's an amazing individual. He finally answered and said, if America does not take the necessary steps, Israel must protect her sovereignty and her nationhood. We will step in if we have to. That's what he said. But most Americans do not realize what you said just a moment ago about they have this messianic complex of bringing back their Messiah, whatever the case. And so a thermonuclear catastrophe does not mean the same to them as it does to us.
Exactly. Khatami was speaking to high school students in Iran last year, about 9 months ago, and he told them, when we destroy Israel, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. When we destroy Israel, Israel's going to retaliate. But we can afford to lose millions because it's a win-win situation. If we destroy Israel, we kill all the Jews, and whoever they kill from us, those Muslims who are going to die are going to be considered martyrs and they're going to go to heaven. Okay. And the Messiah, the Islamic Messiah, will come, because the Shiites believe that the only way the Islamic Messiah can come is only after a catastrophe is created, tragedy in the world, a lot of blood is shed, and that will usher the way for the Messiah to come, for Islam to reign supreme. So their ultimate goal is basically bringing in the Messiah, and whatever the cost is nothing compared to eternity.
One final question. Iraq. What about it?
Right now, we are stuck in Iraq. We are stuck in Iraq because if we withdraw out of Iraq right now, Iran will move in and take over Iraq like lightning. They'll be working with the Muqtada Sadr movement. Afghanistan will fall immediately after. That will put Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and Jordan in jeopardy of a takeover by Iran. Iran last week came out threatening Bahrain of an attack. Iran has become the strongest, largest nation. It is not only threatening Israel, it's threatening the Sunnis. And Iran, actually, if Israel attacks Iran, Israel will be doing the dirty work and the cleanup job to protect the Arabs, because Iran wants to wipe out Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Jordan, which the Iranians do not consider as Islamic enough. And right now, Iran has more power, military power, to wipe out these three countries because they are the strongest power. So our presence in Iraq right now, forget about bringing democracy to the Iraqis. We will never democratize them.
No,
we are wasting our breath on that issue.
Right now,
Right. Our presence there, where we are stuck there, is basically to protect America's interest from Iran taking over the Middle East and basically not only threatening to the Middle East, but attacking America.
I think the second largest oil reserves in the world is in Iraq, I believe, close
That's right.
to it. And, you know, you're right. You cannot democratize the world of Islam.
You cannot. Islam and democracy are not compatible. When you look at the Middle East, Iraq and everything else, all these countries, they're nothing more than tribes with flags. We are basically now in the middle of a tribal fight that they have been doing for centuries, for
right.
a thousand years.
Right.
We're not going to make them love each other.
Right.
And this is why Saddam Hussein was so successful, because he ruled with an iron fist. But right now, we must protect our interest, because the stakes are so high because of Iran's nuclear program that we're stuck. We must end that. In order for us to be able to get out of Iraq right now, we must take care of Iran. We cannot withdraw and leave Iran. Once we take care of Iran, we'll be able to get out of Iraq.
10 seconds. You think we will?
No. Israel is going to have to preempt an attack. We're going to have to be dragged into war, and I hope it won't be too late. We were fools to believe that. So on television, they would say, Israel, Azrael, Azrael is the name of the devil. Israel is evil. The Jews are evil. The Jews are barbaric. Israel is the problem, the source of the problem of all the wars in the Middle East. And that the only time we will have peace in the Middle East is when we kill all the Jews and throw them into the sea.
Now, you really heard that type of rhetoric as
absolutely.
A child.
Absolutely. All
and
over.
It from the news. They
yes.
coming
yeah.
out
in
all
the news. And the people. I would sit and eat dinner at my father's restaurant. People would be sitting all around, and especially we in the South.
But even though the Christianity was predominant in Lebanon at that time, still there was great animosity against Israel.
Yes, because supposedly Israel was the enemy. And that was the feeling amongst most of the Lebanese. Not necessarily, the Christians did not hate, but they knew that Israel was the enemy. And that was a prevailing feeling. However, once the Muslim organized and they created Jaish Lebanon al-Arabi, the Arabic Lebanese army, they started killing the Christians and threatening the Christians. They started massacring the Christians and trying to take over all of Lebanon. They would walk into Christian cities and towns and massacre and destroy the churches. They would walk into our churches and they would burn the churches. They would urinate and defecate on the altar using the Bible as toilet paper. They would kill, they would take the Christian boys and slaughter them. They would nail them on crosses and then put honey on their private parts and on their chests so they can be bitten, stung by bees as they hung and died. They would walk into the bomb shelters. They would rape the women. They would behead the husbands. The last lady that worked for me, they went into her bomb shelter. They tied her to a chair. She was hiding with her family. They tied a knife to her hand and held her 16-year-old son on her lap and made her cut his own throat. The monstrosities they committed were horrifying.
Okay, whenever you relate this from your experience here in America, and people hear it, hear what they will hear right now, they are hearing what you're saying. What do the American people believe? What do they think when they hear you say these kind of things? Do they think that, well, that was just some fanatics in the religion of Islam, and it does not characterize that religion. The religion is really a peaceable, honorable religion, and these are just some fanatics or whatever the case. Is that the spirit you're getting out there, or would our people, our leaders, hopefully be coming to the place that they realize the religion is the cause of this? It's not just a few wild-eyed, evil fanatics. It's the religion. Now, do you agree with what I'm saying here about the religion itself being the cause of all of these problems you've just mentioned, this horror?
I agree with you 100%, and here is why. As we educate America about the background of Islam, see, Americans and Westerners in general, up until 9/11, 2001, they could care less. They didn't care about Islam. People in America were more interested in watching a documentary about Madonna in the last 25 years than watching a documentary about radical Islam. However, since September 11th, we started seeing the shootings of the school in Beslan, shooting children by Muslims, kidnapping, hijacking high school and terrorizing the children, the bombings in Bali, the bombings in Madrid, the bombings in London. It's not only the United States. But I'm going to take it back further to discuss governments and religion. Under the name of Islam, La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, there is no God greater than Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. And this is what you see on the flag of Saudi Arabia. These are the words. These are the words you see hanging behind all the terrorists that behead people. Under that banner, the Muslims massacred Christians in Lebanon. They killed Hindus in India by the millions. Mm-hmm. They killed Armenians in Turkey, 2 million Armenians. They killed Copts in Egypt, Assyrians in Syria, and expelled over 900,000 Jews out of Arab land. All that happened by governments with the approval of Islamic governments, not just by a handful of radicals. Look at the Arabic world today. As the Jews were being expelled out of Libya, out of Jordan, out of Syria, out of Lebanon, as they were butchered and killed and burned and maimed, where were the governments of the governments? The Islamic governments did not agree with the massacring.
They agreed with it.
They agreed with it. Today, when we see all the bombing across the world, from 9/11 on, did we see any demonstrations in the Arabic, moderate governments of the Arabic world?
Yes, we saw demonstrations. They were thrilled and happy that the bombings took place.
Exactly, Jimmy, exactly. They were dancing in the streets of Syria. They were dancing in the streets of Jordan. They were dancing in the streets of Gaza and the Palestinian territories. They were dancing in the streets of New Jersey. In the United States,
are you serious?
In the mosques, yes, across from the World Trade Center, the Muslims were rejoicing. The echoes in our American prisons by the Muslims screaming Allahu Akbar when they heard the news of September 11th, they were singing and dancing in our American prisons. This is what the media does not want to speak about. If it is a handful of radicals, where are the governments of the Middle East organizing demonstrations and coming out and condemning what has been being done in the name of their religion?
They aren't there.
What about Jordan, the moderate country of Jordan, where we see King Abdullah and his wife Rania, who look like they just stepped out of the pages of Vogue magazine, right, who were educated in Britain? The only demonstrations we see is demonstrations to against the cartoon. Look what happened with the cartoon controversy. Look what happened when the Pope last year made the statement about quoting in an intellectual speech from the 7th century, a Byzantine emperor saying that Islam was spread through the sword and through forced conversions. Supermarkets were torched. A nun was killed in India. Thousands of Christians were injured. People were killed by demonstrations, and we saw this all over the Islamic nations. How come we do not see any of those people coming out and demonstrating by the thousands when people are killed in the Western world in the name of their religion?
They're in favor of it.
Exactly.
And you brought
actions
up.
Speak louder than words. We need to start watching what people are doing and not listen to empty verbiage by talking heads on Western TV stations,
right,
by Muslim,
right,
lobby group, right, selling us a lie about the peaceful religion of Islam.
And you brought out in your book, and of course anyone that keeps up with current events will know this, the Islamic children are taught from the moment of birth to hate the infidel and the Jew. We're the infidel, the Jew, we're great Satan, Israel is a little Satan. So it is born in them,
yes,
from the time that they can comprehend. Therefore, we will see pictures of little Arab children dressed up like terrorists with fake bombs upon them. They're literally being raised to be slaughtered for the sake of Islam, and that's what we're dealing with.
Exactly, and this is what we're dealing with, this is what we're seeing right now. But this has been going on for generations. This didn't start now.
Right,
I say,
right,
the Arab children are taught hatred towards the Jews from their mother's milk and towards the infidels. By the way, you know, we hear a lot, people in the West think that, you know, the Muslims only hate the Jews. No, in the Quran, anytime the Jews are mentioned, they are mentioned with the Christians. Mm-hmm. The Quran says, Al-Yahudu wa-Nasara, the Jews and the Christians. It's not only exclusively the Jews.
Right,
we
right.
are the infidels. My parents were refugees with me when I was 9 months old. They had to flee our town and go hide in another section of Lebanon because the Muslims were attacking our town. My home was blown up in 1975. I was 10 years old when my 9/11 happened to me, when the Muslims, in trying to take over my area of Lebanon, bombed my home, bringing it down and burying me under the rubble wounded. I ended up in a hospital for 2.5 months. And after many surgeries, I would be laying up in bed, hooked up to machines on both my arms with needles. And I would ask my parents, as an innocent child, suffering, laying in a bed with pain, why did they do this to us? And my father would tell me, because we are Christians, the Muslims consider us infidels and they want to kill us. So I learned as a Christian in the Middle East, since I was 10 years old, that I am wanted dead simply because I was born into the Christian faith. See, here in America, when Christians think about persecution, we look at persecution. If I take my Bible to work and people look at me the wrong way,
yeah,
I'm being persecuted.
Right, yeah,
that's
yeah,
our
yeah,
idea of
yeah,
persecution.
Right, yeah, uh-huh.
You know,
right.
They're not allowing me. My neighbors complained because mm-hmm. I put a nativity scene on my front yard on Christmas. That's our idea of
yeah,
persecution.
You're exactly right.
People in the rest of the world are being massacred, killed, beheaded, raped, buried alive simply because they're born into the Christian faith.
Okay, whenever all this was taking place in your city, before it got to your part, did you realize, and you and your parents, did you realize, Bridget, that you were going to be bombed at any point in time? It was just a matter of time that your house would be blown up, and or did you expect it not to get that far?
We expected it to come to South Lebanon because the whole country erupted in war. We had a lot of people fleeing from the towns that were massacred and coming and hiding in our town and telling us stories about what was happening, and we knew it was coming our way. My father even went to the banks in Beirut and withdrew almost all his money to bring us to the United States. He took everything in banknotes so we can flee. 2 days later, our home was blown up and all my father's money was burned to ashes and our lives were destroyed. My father was 70 years old, and not only he lost all his life savings, but he became deaf for the rest of his life.
Now, your mother, was she wounded in that time? She became gravely ill, didn't she?
My mother was the only one who was not wounded in the early bombing of our house. Only my father and I. My father became deaf and I was wounded.
But your mother was taken to a hospital in Israel.
But that was later. Yeah,
that was 7 years later.
Oh, I see. Uh-huh.
That was after 7 years. Once they came to our area and they bombed our area, I became wounded. And then when we left the hospital,
you were buried under something, weren't you, Bridget?
Buried under the rubble of my home. They couldn't get me to a hospital for a day and a half after I was wounded. By the time they got me there, I was almost dead.
Well, how long did this conflict last? How many years during this time?
Well, it lasted for 7 years. When I left the hospital and we came back home, our home was no longer the home we
left. How did your family survive with everything you had destroyed? Your home destroyed, your finances gone?
We ended up living in a bomb shelter underground with no electricity, no water, and very little food. 7 years, from 1975 till 1982. And when we entered the bomb shelter, we thought it's only going to be 2 weeks. It's only going to be maybe 2 months. This is going to be solved. America is going to come and save the Christians. France is going to come save the Christians. Britain is going to come save the Christians. We thought that the Christian countries of the world is going to see what's happening, the massacring that is being done to the Christians, and they're going to come do something. But no one paid attention. And we knew what our fate was going to be, because we were surrounded to be slaughtered. So few people from my town went to Israel and begged for help, because Israel was to our back. And we knew of supposedly the two enemies, the Muslims before us and the Jews behind us. We knew that if we go to the Jews are not going to slaughter us, because we had more shared values with them.
Of course, so you're saying that some of the elders in your area went to Israel thinking that it can't be worse than what we're experiencing.
Exactly. They went to Israel, flagged down an Israeli patrol, and said, "We are not going to last 48 hours. You've got 48 hours and you'll have the Palestinians at your border, and us will be massacred. We need your help. We need each other's help." And within 48 hours, Israel started coming in the middle of the night.
Now what year was that? 80 what?
That was 1975-76.
Oh, 75-76.
Right. In that 7 years that you were in the bomb shelter in an area, how did you survive? How did the families there survive?
It was so difficult. It was barely existing. In order for us to get some food, my mother and I would crawl under the bombs outside of our bomb shelter. And we would dig out grass and dandelions and different vegetations that grew out around our bomb shelter. Even thorn. I learned how to peel thorn in my tender young fingers at age 10 and 11 and 12 so I can eat the stalk that grew inside of the thorn.
It was that critical.
That critical. In order to get some water, we would crawl under sniper's bullets to a nearby spring. In my hometown, it was called Marjayun, the Valley of Spring. We had 8 springs in our town. And there was a spring 5 minutes from my home. And we would crawl under sniper's bullets to get some water. And every time before we left, we would say our last goodbyes, because we did not know if we're going to come back alive or dead.
Many of your friends were killed, I'm assuming.
By the time I was 20, I had buried most of my friends. I had only 4 friends alive.
One young man you were planning to marry.
One young man who was very dear and close to me. I remember he stopped by one day. In 1978, we had been fighting for 2 years. We had lost so many people, so many young Christian men, because, you know, we the Christians are very small to begin with. And without Israel's help, we didn't even survive 2 years. But Israel was only helping at night. Our Christian men were being trained and helping us during the day. And he stopped by, he said, "We heard on the radios that tonight we're going to be attacked. And I just want to wish you a merciful death, because I don't think we're going to last." And he left. And I remember at age 13 years old, putting on my Sunday best, my Easter dress that my mother had sewed for me, because I wanted to look pretty when I'm dead, knowing that there would be no one to bury me. And we sat in the corner of our bomb shelter, and my parents and I held each other's hands, and we said the Lord's Prayer. And we had nothing but hope, and we had nothing but faith, and we knew there is nothing that can save us but the grace of God. And my parents said to me, if they come to slaughter us tonight, you just run towards Israel and you never look back. We'll create a distraction. We lived a long life. We are old. You are young. You see, my parents were married for over 22 years. They could not have any children. My mother was 55 years old, and my father was 60 when I was born.
When you were born. How about that?
So I was truly the miracle in their lives. And they said, you know, we lived a long life. You just saved your life. Thank God I didn't have to make that decision that night. And the only reason we survived is because that's when the Israeli military came in physically into Lebanon, set up checkpoints around our towns to protect us. Israel set up military bases and established the security zone.
When did you come to the place that you realized that what you had been told about Jews, what you had been told about Israel, had not been the truth, and you found out what they really were? How did that come about?
Well, by the time I was 11 years old, as a very, very young child, I knew that we are alive because of Israel,
As it regards this coming election. I mean, it's just a guess. Nobody probably knows.
Nobody knows. They are, you know, it's especially in a political campaign, that is done very creatively. But we know we have lobby group in the United States, for example, like CARE, the Council on American Islamic Relations, which is funded from money coming from the Gulf, from Saudi Arabia, and from those rich Arab sheikhs. And CARE is using its money in the United States to lobby our elected official and fund their campaigns. For example, Keith Ellison, the Muslim who was elected to Congress in Minnesota, and his victory party, shouts of Allahu Akbar ringed through the room. Now, this should send shivers down the spines of every American.
Exactly.
Those are the words that terrorists who are committing suicide attacks and beheading Americans scream Allahu Akbar as they're slitting Americans' throats or as they're flying airplanes into skyscrapers.
Did he have a predominantly Muslim community that voted him in, or were some of our people so stupid?
Democrats, yes, some of our people are very ignorant that they voted him in, and a lot of Muslim constituency in his area voted him in. See, what's happening also is the Democrats in our country want to appear so tolerant that they're overcompensating. You had Jewish people on Keith Ellison's campaign running his campaign.
That's hard to believe.
They're Jewish, they overcompensate because they wanted to appear more tolerant and loving. This is the problem we have in our country right now, is we must understand that not all Muslims are terrorists, but we must understand Islam's and the law of Islam. And that is, in Islam, an elected official, if he is a practicing Muslim, like Keith Ellison is, for example, and wanted to swear on the Quran in particular, goes to show you how practicing Muslim he is. In Islam, if you are a loyal Muslim, your loyalty is to Islam first,
right?
Not to your country, not
right,
to your family,
right,
not
right,
to your
right.
own flesh and blood. So if America is faced with war, and this elected official has to choose between protecting Americans and America's interest and protecting Islam, this elected official, as a Muslim, will have to choose to protect Islam against the United
States. You made the statement in your book that they interviewed quite a number of young people who were Muslims, and they gave them particular scenarios. Would you defend America against so-and-so who is a Muslim? Hussein was one of them, Saddam.
Right.
And I think you said in your book, and I'm trying to pull it up in my memory, something like 60-something percent said,
right,
no, they would not fight against Saddam.
That's right. That's
no matter
right.
what he did to America.
80%.
80%
said that they will not fight with the United States against any Arabic country in the Middle East.
Okay, the chaplains, go ahead.
What is even more interesting is this study that was just done now, a couple months ago, where the Pew Report polled Muslim Americans in America who are Muslim citizens and asked them if they support suicide bombing. So what martyrdom operations we're talking now. In the United States, 26% today in 2007, 26% of Muslim Americans who hold American citizenship believe and support suicide operations. Right. That means they believe and support operations committed by Muhammad Ataz and people like that because they believe under certain circumstances that is justified.
I believe that you in essence, you didn't say it, but you alluded to it, that England is further down this road than we are here in America right now. I said a stage two, they're stage four in England.
That's right.
They've gotten to the place to where that it's now, you know, law is in jeopardy there in favor of Islamic law. Is that correct?
Correct. They are changing the laws in the schools. They are changing the laws in the government. A survey was done in Britain a few months ago where they asked Muslims in Britain, British Muslims, where their loyalty lies, if they would support Sharia law. 60% of British Muslims said they would much rather live under Sharia law than under British law. Now, these are British citizens living and enjoying the freedom and democracy of the West. See, we in the West right now are saying, if we can just bring democracy to the Middle East, if we can just bring democracy to Islamic countries, they're going to love our way of life.
Why is it that the American people do not really seem to know and understand what the religion of Islam is really like? That they don't understand how that women are treated as property, pretty much. They don't understand the murder, the bloodshed, the demand that the whole world be taken over for Islam, which would throw the world into a dark ages of unprecedented proportion. I heard the other day over the news, and I can't quote the exact numbers, and I don't have the source, but they said in the last 10 years that over 100 Nobel Prizes, some of them peace, some of them science, some of them whatever the case, have been granted to Israelis or Jews around the world. Muslims, two.
Yeah.
You understand?
And one of them was to Yasser Arafat.
It was.
Now, that's the greatest terrorist in the world.
That's right.
That's when I lost my respect to the Nobel Prize.
Yeah, you're exactly
that's
right.
That's when the Nobel Prize became nothing worthy of respect, when they gathered together and awarded to a man who's
terrorist.
A terrorist leader who has more blood on his hands than any of other leaders we know in our lifetime. But you know, Jimmy, the problem is lack of education. Americans who are educated on the facts, who are studying Islam, are realizing and understanding that the problem is Islam. Those who are watching the news are understanding. The problem now is we have people who would much rather watch American Idol, Survivor, reality television.
Yeah.
We need to pull them away from that and educate them, because I believe in the American public. I believe if Americans are informed, they will do something about it. Just like the people that watch the doctors want to become a part of a suicide killing machine in Britain.
Yeah.
Now, these people all of a sudden are asking, you know, it is not only the poor. It is the wealthy. Maybe we need to reconsider. Maybe we need to look at Islam. And you're seeing more of that. And actually, the terrorists are bringing it about by their actions.
In your travels all over this nation and around the world, really, but especially this nation.
And what we're also doing, Jimmy, to educate the American public in particular, our organization, AmericanCongressForTruth.org, was founded specifically to mobilize Americans, educate them, empower them, inform them as to how they can become a voice affecting their community and our nation. I formed the organization because I realized not only we need to educate, which we do, we send people emails every day or every other day, educating them about issues, what's happening in our country, but we also show them when there's a bill being voted on the floor or when there's a bill about to come out, we immediately send an email and say, this bill about our national security is about to be voted on. Call your elected officials. People need to be given the tools to be involved. And I urge everyone watching to go to our website, AmericanCongressForTruth.org, and sign up to receive our emails and action alerts so they can be informed. Right now, I ask for those who are watching to pray for us. We just hired an executive director to set up chapters nationwide to mobilize patriotic Americans, to have them become the voice who's going to change our nation. We can no longer sit and wait on our elected officials sitting in Washington, D.C., being influenced by lobbyists to serve us. We must wake up and take things into our own hands to put the pressure on our elected officials to make them act.
Bridget, you know, I've seen you on the news several times in the last year, and I've watched very interestingly. What is your response to these ABC, NBC, CBS, all of the networks when you share this story? The reaction I get from the people doing the interviews is, well, you're just one little segment over here. In other words, I get the opinion outside of Fox News that they really don't believe what you're saying.
Well, you are correct to a point. When we started speaking out 5 years ago, when I would say, like I detail in my book, how the doctors, the lawyers, our Muslim neighbors in Lebanon turned against us, people used to look at me and say, well, maybe she's exaggerating. But as this war on terror develops, and by the way, let's call it the war on Islamofascism, one of the things that aggravate me greatly about our president, and I think he failed our citizens by not calling a spade, by not calling this war of what it is.
Right,
this
right,
war yeah. is a war by Islam against the rest of the world. If you take Islam out of the war on terror, we wouldn't have a war on terror.
Right.
And in the last few years, when we would talk about how our, you know, it's an ideology, people did not want to believe it. But as this war develops on Islamofascism, and when we hear about a ring of doctors in England wanting to blow up the same hospitals that they practiced in, then people have to sit back and say, you know, we've heard that before. We've heard it from those people before. We have been warned. It's no news. It's nothing new. We have said that before. And finally, we are seeing our voice resonate among others. Slowly but surely, it's coming.
Do you feel that you are making some headway, that some people are, in essence, you pretty well answered it, but I want to dig into it a little deeper. Do you meet in your addresses wherever you go, do you meet much hostility?
Oh, yes. What a question. Absolutely. And places I have to speak, I just spoke at a church in California. The FBI called the church and said, you need to beef up security because there are a lot of death threats, and you need to make sure, if you want to have speakers like this, you need to have security. We had over 12 undercover guards fully armed in the church. And an American church in the United States for someone like me to speak.
Okay,
and that's in a church.
That's different than what I'm talking about, though. Like you speak at a lot of colleges.
Oh, yes.
Now, I happen to believe that the state of our universities is sad, to be frank with you, at a lot of the fault or all that's going on there. Do you get much opposition? They don't believe what you say, or they don't agree with what you say, or they just don't care. They would rather have Islam than they would what they have now. Do you have that?
Oh, in this area, colleges are very dangerous to any conservative speaker. First of all, they don't even want us on campus. If you are a liberal speaker who bashes America, who badmouths America, badmouths Israel, you're welcomed with the red carpet laid out for you as a speaker. The college university allows a student to sponsor you. They even fund your speaking engagement. When conservative students want to bring in conservative speakers like me and others, you cannot believe the red tape. We're not allowed in, and when we are allowed, we have to have extreme security with us, bodyguards, office security. The FBI gets involved, the Department of Homeland Security gets involved, and here is why. Because our universities have been infiltrated to such a level by the Muslims on the universities that it is those who are creating the problem. Do you realize that on American colleges today, the Muslim Student Association has more chapters on American college campuses than the Democrat and the Republicans combined? The Muslims group, more than the Democrats and the Republicans. They are funded by the government of Saudi Arabia, and what has been happening in the last 16 years, Saudi Arabia has been able to exploit a program set up by our government called the Title VI program. And that program was set up for, after World War II, for our students to be educated about different cultures, different languages, so they may be an asset to our government. What's happening is Saudi Arabia is setting up Middle East science departments and political science departments and financing them and appointing Arab professors who are anti-America, anti-our policy, anti-Israel, and this is why we're seeing the brainwashing in general on all our college campuses, from the Ivy League to the community colleges, to hating America, brainwashing our children to thinking that we are the problem because we are rich and the poor Muslims who are suffering, that's why they're turning to suicide bombing. They're literally feeding our kids lies and brainwashing them.
I've preached all over Africa, and I remember them telling me one day that they would send their brightest students to the university. If they sent them to the university in Moscow, they came back confirmed capitalist. If they sent them to the universities here in the States, they came back confirmed communist.
Wow.
Now you think of that.
Wow. Wow.
And now in your, we've touched on it here and there, but what is your advice, your word, your statement to the people of the United States? What should we do about this problem? What steps should we be taking? What should be the activity of the common, not common, but the American citizen?
Get involved. Learn.
What do you mean
get
by
involved.
Getting involved?
And what I mean by that is join organizations like ours. American Congress for Truth, ACT, was founded as an activist organization to mobilize and inform American citizens how they can make a difference.
You're saying pressure applied to congressmen, to senators, still carry some weight.
Oh, absolutely. And this is why I tell people you must sign up to receive our free emails and action alerts. And I'll give you an example. I talk to people all the time, and I ask them, to elected officials, how many people do you need to hear from to make an issue your top priority where you can pass a bill about it? You will be surprised. 40 to 50 people. That's it. You know, people sometimes, the average American thinks, what is my voice going to count? I am one. My congressman needs to hear from 50,000 people before they make a difference. No, it's 40
right.
to 50 people, and here is
right.
why. Because they believe that if they hear from one person,
yeah.
he or she are representing 1,000 voters.
That's it.
And that translates
yeah.
to 40 to 50,000 voters
mm-hmm.
on election day.
Right.
That can make or break an election. We give tips to people on how they can get involved. For example,
mm-hmm.
if you know there is a mosque in your community or an Islamic institution and you suspect it suspicious activity, go down to your local city hall. Find out who owns the deed to that mosque. Is it a Saudi foundation? Is it some Arab sheikhs outside of the United States? Write their names down. Come home. Call your local FBI office. It's a free call. Turn the names to them. We are the eyes and ears of our government. The FBI can start monitoring the mosques. For example, if you are over the age of 55 years old, do you know that in America today, every senior citizen over the age of 55 years old can sign up to attend the university course free of charge? We want to mobilize senior citizens to sign up at the Middle East Science Department or Political Science Department just to monitor the professors. Because somebody who is mature, who's 55 years old, is the
They need her experience. And I'm asking for that divine protection, Lord, and that the programming last week and this week will help to awaken people who need to be awakened to the danger that's in our midst. And I'll ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. I want to make it clear as we begin today, we do not hate Muslims, not at all. We love Muslims as we love everybody. Anyone who is a genuine Christian, a Bible Christian, loves everybody. But I'll say something we do hate. We do hate that which steals and kills and destroys. Jesus loved the sinner, but he hated the sin because he knew what the sin would do in the hearts and lives of individuals. And we love the Muslim. We pray for them. And I would encourage you to pray for them as well. And if you happen to have the occasion to have Muslims as your acquaintances or whatever the case, you as a Christian would be kind and gracious to them as you ought to be. But at the same time, we must be alerted to the truth, not only for the sake of our nation and the world, but for the sake of Muslims also. Bridget, I want to start this program today by dealing with the proposed or the effort made for the gasoline bombs in London and Glasgow, Scotland, I think as well, which would have killed an awful lot of people had the perpetrators been successful in what they were attempting to do. I looked at our newsmen who were relating this incident because it was, of course, on all the news here in this nation and should have been. They were perplexed. They were stating, we do not understand. These individuals who were the perpetrators of this effort, which would have killed hundreds of innocent people had it been successful, were doctors. They were, some of them were vastly intelligent according to their IQs. How in the world, why in the world would they do such a thing? Because the idea in this nation has been, well, these people have issues that are doing these things. And you know, these mean old Americans, you know, whatever bad that happens to us, or even those in England, we are due that. Because these people have been deprived, they've been set up on, they've been hurt, and they have been atrocities committed against them. What, I don't know, but at any rate, but these are professional people. They are educated. They are medical doctors, and there's very little education you can get higher than a medical doctor. How could they do such a thing? I looked at the perplexity on their faces. What they did not know nor understand was that it's got nothing to do with you were being deprived as a Palestinian in a refugee camp or something of that nature. All of those things may play a tiny part, but only a tiny part. But it's the religion of Islam that is back of this thing. And that's why that these medical doctors planned and made every attempt to carry out what they did. Would you address that, please?
Yes, what we are finding out, and the world, we already knew that, but the mainstream media can no longer ignore the fact that we are fighting an ideology. An ideology that can take a doctor who's supposed to save lives, it can take a doctor to strap bombs on his body and go to kill thousands. We are fighting an ideology that is able to alter human instinct and take a mother and basically make her strap suicide belt on her own child and send him out to blow himself up, not only kill himself, but kill other children in the name of religion. This is the fact that the West has to face, that this war we are fighting comes out of one book called the Holy Quran and the religion of Islam.
In other words, it affects all alike, whether they are intellectuals, educated, poverty-stricken, it makes no difference.
It makes no difference. See, the leftists in this country and in the West and the mainstream media used to say, oh, if we just give them a little bit more money, you know, if they just are rich, because we in the West judge everything according to we are such a materialistic society,
right,
that we
right.
think if you have the big house, if you drive the Mercedes, if you have the money yeah. in the bank, what more could you want? I mean, this is the life.
Yeah.
We have lost the spiritual connection in the United States.
That's
and in
right.
the West in general.
Yeah. Yeah.
However, in the Islamic world, what bonds all these people together is basically not money, but their faith in Allah and what the Quran tells them to do.
In other words, they are setting out to, number one, kill the infidel, because they look at America and even England as nations which are stopping them from destroying Israel. Is that right?
Exactly. Exactly. And not only stopping them
from
destroying
Israel. And they want to evangelize the world with Islam.
Exactly. They want to turn the whole world into Islam. I mean, the last press release that we had from al-Zawahiri, the second man in charge of al-Qaeda, he said, we want to establish an Islamic Khalifa beginning in Iraq and spreading through Europe and then throughout the world. They're telling us exactly what they want to do.
Do they have a chance of doing that?
Yes, they do have a chance of doing that if we do not stop them, if we do not wake up now. Now we have a chance in waking up and stopping them. Look at it this way. America is at stage 2 cancer. Europe is at stage 3 cancer. Mm-hmm. At stage 2 cancer, you can still check yourself into the hospital, have surgery, get the cancer cells out of your body, go through chemotherapy, and then you have a chance of survival. If you wait too long until the cancer is at stage 4,
right.
even if you wake up then and you decide to have surgery, it's already too late.
You're terminal.
So what we're seeing right now is these radical, if we want to call them radical Islamists, the doctors who decide to blow themselves up for the sake of those leftists who may be watching, what we are seeing is they are infiltrating our society on every level, and they are using everything in their power, such as using doctors and intellectuals, or what people in the West perceive as intellectuals and smart people, basically because we put our guards down to these people to commit terrorist attacks. The problem is so severe that now we must open our eyes and we must realize that poverty has nothing to do with it. It is ideology. What we also need to pay attention to is they are coming to our countries. They are trying to use everything in their power to enter our country legally or illegally. Let's remember that two of these doctors that are now imprisoned because of the attack in Britain tried to come to the United States.
Mm-hmm.
They applied to be accepted in a hospital in Philadelphia.
And why were they wanting to come to this country?
They wanted to come to this country to do exactly
there
here what
go.
They tried
there
to do
go.
In England,
yeah.
and that is kill infidels, regardless of their Jews. They want to kill Christians and Jews and Buddhists and atheists and everybody else, anybody who's a non-Muslim.
And, you know, I'm glad you brought that up, because the fact is the American public needs to understand that they are killing people of all faiths around the world.
Exactly. Yeah. Of all faith. And, you know, we in this country so sadly put everything, well, I'm a Democrat and you're a Republican and, you know, I'm a Democrat. You know, they're going to like me because I'm on their side. What we are seeing is the terrorism issue is not a Republican issue. It's not a Democratic issue. It's an American issue.
Right.
It's not a Buddhist issue. It's not a born-again Christian issue. It's not
right.
a right-wing
right.
issue. It's not
right.
a left issue.
Right.
It's an American issue. I don't see any of the beheaders that beheaded Daniel Pearl or Nick Berg or the other 35 hostages in Iraq stop for 1 second and ask them, are you a Democrat or are you a Republican?
Right. right.
Are you a born-again
yeah.
Christian
yeah.
or are you an atheist? They beheaded them because they were Americans, regardless of their religion, regardless of their sect, regardless of their political affiliation. They were Westerners, period. And this is what America needs to wake up to.
What about the cell groups that you say in your book, and you list some of the places that there are organized cell groups, which we'll use the term radical, with intentions of causing harm to this nation, and that they are fomenting plans constantly to wreak havoc in this country. Those cells are here now in this country?
Those cells are here now, have been here now for the last 10 years. We have known about their existence here for the last 10 years, and they are plotting our destruction as we speak. And I'll give you examples. For example, you hear a lot of Hamas and Hezbollah on the news. You know, it's always on the news, there is war. People think, that's 8,000 miles away problem. It doesn't affect me. You know, they're not here. We think that Al-Qaeda is our problem here.
Mm-hmm.
Of all the terrorist organizations that have set up shop on American soil, the top three are Al-Qaeda, Islamic Jihad, and Hamas. Hamas, not Al-Qaeda. Hamas has the largest infrastructure on American soil. Hamas has cells in over 40 states in the United States.
That's what just took over the Gaza Strip.
That's what just took over the Gaza Strip. They're here. They have sold in over 40 states in the United
in
States.
In this country.
In this country. In my book, I even detailed the cities and the states where they are in. They have cells in New York City, in Boston, in Massachusetts, in New York, in Washington, D.C., in Laurel, Maryland, in Springfield, Virginia, in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, in Boca Raton, in Orlando, in Cincinnati, in
Nashville.
Ohio, Nashville, Raleigh, North Carolina, and the list of Colorado, Denver, Tucson, Texas.
Do our authorities know about these cells? I'm sure they do.
They know about these cells. These cells, Hamas, and I'm going to use for example, talks in their charter about destroying terrorists, what they consider terrorists in our country. And they consider terrorists the Lions Clubs, the Rotary Clubs, the Kiwanis, and the likes, and the Freemasons. Now, how many people watching who are members of the Lions Clubs and the Rotary Clubs who wake up in the morning to go to their meetings, to raise money, to do good in their community, know that they are mentioned in the Hamas charter, the Hamas, the largest terrorist organization on our soil? The problem is not only Hamas. The problem is Hezbollah. Hezbollah has 11 cells in America. They have cells. Do you know, and I'm going to use the state of Texas as an example, because, you know, when we think of Texas, that's like yeehaw land. You cannot get any more Americana than Texas.
That's right.
Do you know that in Texas alone, they have 2,500 Hezbollah members? Texas, not their Bornistan, Michigan, where you expect
who,
them.
Who are these individuals who are members of Hezbollah or whoever, whatever? Who are they? Are they Americans? Are they transplanted Arabs over here? Who are they?
Both. They are American citizens born and raised here. They are illegal aliens who've been smuggled through the Mexican border. What the problem we have now with the border, and this is why it is so important that we shut the border down, we close our borders, is the terrorists have figured out a way to work with the gangs in smuggling terrorists into the country. Al-Qaeda is working with the MS-13 gang, the notorious terrorist gang, in smuggling terrorists into the country. Al-Qaeda is paying the MS-13 gang between $25,000 to $50,000 per terrorist to be smuggled into the
That's
country.
Right.
Hezbollah is doing the same thing. We suspect that thousands have been smuggled into the country via the Mexican border.
And we saw that come to life just a couple of months ago with this attempted attack on a military base. And when they tracked this down, many of them came into this country illegally through the Mexican border.
Exactly. What is happening is the gang and the drug cartels are could care less now about smuggling Mexicans. I mean, that is a major problem. But Mexicans don't pay like terrorists. So you have terrorists paying between $25,000 and $50,000. And that's now the drug deals. That's the business that's coming through the border. They are coming into our country, and they are directly going to the major cities in the United States where there is a large Islamic concentration, like Miami, Washington, D.C., New York, and New Jersey, Dearborn, Michigan, L.A., Texas, Houston. By the way, do you know that in Houston alone, they have 65 mosques in Houston? The city of Houston.
No, I didn't know that.
They are coming here.
How many mosques are in the United States as a whole right now?
We expect right now about 2,000. 300 madrasas in the United States. Madrasas. Madrasas are radical Islamic schools that brainwash children that we all infidel need to be dead. They are basically teaching them Sharia law and the Quran. When you hear the word madrasa, you hear it, you think, you know, Pakistan, Indonesia. But you don't think madrasas in the United States. On our website, AmericanCongressForTruth.org, we post a petition and we quote what they're teaching in those madrasas. They are teaching, we quote the book, we take paragraphs out of the book, they are teaching that Christian and Jews are apes and pigs because they are cursed by Allah. They are teaching if there's a Jew behind the tree, go and kill him.
And that's not in the Gaza Strip, that's here.
That's here. In the United States, on American soil.
Once again, is it acceptable by the authorities that they know about this, I'm assuming?
Here's the problem. Freedom of religion. Our enemy is using our laws against us, and political correctness is killing us. Political correctness needs to be thrown in the garbage where it belongs. It is the devil, it is evil, and it does not belong in our society.
Right,
we must
right.
stop political correctness
right,
now
right,
and start
right,
calling a spade a spade.
Right.
The problem is, because of political correctness, it is shackles around our ankles that is preventing us from doing something about the hate education happening in the mosques. We need to change the laws. We need to start putting pressure on our elected officials to change the laws and to start monitoring mosques. What they're teaching in mosques, see, all this nurturing of terrorist mentality is happening in the mosques in the United mm-hmm. States. While we in our churches preach love, preach forgiveness, treat your neighbor the way you want to be treated, judge not others lest you be judged, judge not others lest you be judged, love others, I mean, do not kill, do not steal, do not lie. These are our commandments. This is what we teach our children. In Islam, it is the opposite. In my book, I detail a study about what they're teaching in mosques in the United States. What's happening is most of the mosques in the United States and the world are supported by the government of Saudi Arabia because of the oil money.
Right.
We pump the gas and they pump poison all throughout the world using our money through
right.
the oil wealth,
right.
brainwashing
right.
millions around the world.
All right. How much money is pouring into for instance, you know, the candidates for the highest office in the world are traveling all over this nation. How much money is sneaking in from Saudi Arabia?
An interview with Brigitte Gabrielle. Few people in the world today know more about the religion of Islam, its aims, its direction, and its intended goals than Brigitte Gabrielle. Today you'll hear Brigitte's firsthand account of the religion of Islam and how she learned what the religion actually is. Here's evangelist Jimmy Swaggart.
What a delight to be with you today. This is evangelist Jimmy Swaggart, and I'm very pleased to have Donnie and Francis with us today. I'm very glad to have them, and we're glad to have you because you are the reason for this programming. And we're very, very happy today to have a very special guest that I've been telling you about the last couple of weeks, Brigitte Gabrielle. And Brigitte is used of the Lord possibly as few women today as it regards some of the great problems that's facing our nation, I should say. Let me make a few statements before we get started here today. I personally believe that the United States of America is facing problems that are greater than we have ever faced before in our history, greater than Pearl Harbor, greater than monolithic former Soviet communism, greater than the Cold War, greater than Vietnam, or whatever the case may have been. Some of those were trying times, and if sons and daughters were lost, that was very trying for the parents and the loved ones. But what we're facing today, I personally feel is greater. I personally feel is more dangerous. I personally feel is a greater threat to our nation, to our way of life, than we have ever faced before in history. Unfortunately, most of the leaders of our nation do not seem to see that. Unfortunately, the nation seems to be very much unaware of what is at our doorsteps, to be frank with you. I don't know of any person in the world today, there may be many, but I'm not personally acquainted with them, who understands this threat, who understands this danger, who understands this problem, as this young lady that's seated here beside us today. Brigitte was born and raised in Lebanon, and you are Arab, I would think. Am I correct on that or not? Correct me.
Christians of the Middle East are not Arabs, but during the Islamic invasion, we were stripped out of our languages and forced to speak the Arabic language and became Arab phones, basically people who speak the Arabic language.
But not really Arab.
No.
Well, I'm glad I cleared that up. I'm going to ask Bridget to deal with some aspects. She can go in any direction she so desires. Of her early days, her birth, her being raised in the country of Lebanon. We have been in this beautiful country. At least it was years past. When we were there, it was in the midst of the so-called Peace for Galilee campaign, and it was torn all to pieces. We were taken by the Israeli authorities as a news crew all the way into Beirut. And that was about the time, I suppose, that you were having some tremendous problems at that time.
Yes.
Now, I've read your book, and I think that this book is one of the most necessary works that need to be carefully addressed, read, studied of any book in this nation today as it regards the subject matter at hand. It's entitled, Because They Hate. Now, I want to know some things about this. Brigitte, am I pronouncing that correctly?
Yes.
Close.
Yes,
close.
You are.
Close. You were raised Roman Catholic, really. Am I correct?
Yes, Maronite Christians. The majority of the Christians in Lebanon are Maronite, which is the same thing. We come under the Catholic Church, the Pope, the Vatican is the head of the church.
Right. And you were raised in a little town not too very far from the Israeli-Lebanese border, correct?
Correct.
And your life was uneventful and very pleasant and enjoyable until the whole world exploded. I am correct on that as well.
Correct.
Your parents were professional people. Your dad made an excellent living.
Mm-hmm.
And you, as a young girl, enjoyed life, I suppose.
Yes.
And then something happened that completely disrupted all of that. And would you begin there or wherever you desire?
Yes. I actually would like to begin talking about Lebanon. Many people do not realize that Lebanon used to be the only majority Christian country in the Middle East. When people think of the Middle East, they think the Middle East is all Muslim, all Arabs. They don't realize that Lebanon used to be the only democracy, Arabic democracy in the Middle East. Democracy is not starting with Iraq today. In the 40s, when Lebanon got its independence from France, we were set up as a republic, very much like the United States of America. We were the only Arabic, supposedly, country that elects its officials. And because of our Judeo-Christian majority and heritage, we were good in business. We focused on growing the country. We were multicultural. We were open-minded. We were fair. We were tolerant. We opened our arms and welcomed everybody who wanted to come to our country because we wanted to share with them the westernization that we had created in the heart of the Arabic world.
Can I interrupt you a second?
Yes.
What was the predominant religious persuasions of Lebanon at that time?
the predominant religion among the Christians were the Maronites. It was Christian.
No, I'm talking about the religions as a whole. How many Muslims were there, et cetera, et cetera?
The majority were Christians. The minority were Sunnis, Muslims. The Shiites were a small fraction of the Islamics in Lebanon, and they were basically based in the south. And there is a very small Druze minority, which also a sect of Islam.
And you go ahead and continue with your statement about Lebanon.
We opened our hearts to all the Arabic world. Muslims from all around the Arabic world used to send their children to study in our universities because we had built the best universities in the Arabic world. They graduated and worked in our economy because we had built the best economy in the heart of the Middle East, and we didn't have any oil. Lebanon became Paris of the Middle East, the banking capital of the Middle East. National Geographic magazine in the mid-60s, 1965, had a front cover on National Geographic magazine said, Lebanon, the Garden of Eden, Eden of the Middle East. And this is what we had become. But sadly, Jimmy, as the years passed, we, the Christians, became the minority and the Muslims became the majority.
Well, I want to know how that happened. That's what I was about to ask. How is it? If the Muslims were a minority, you didn't say how small a minority or how large a minority, but at any rate, how did they come to gain the ascendancy in the nation?
Because we Christians do not have as many children as the Muslims do. We Christians get married to one spouse until death do us part. We have two, three, maybe four children by a stretch. From the time our children are born, we start thinking about what education we're going to give them, what schools we're going to send them to, what lifestyle we're going to give them, what neighborhoods we're going to live in for our children. The Muslims, on the other hand, are allowed to marry up to four wives at a time, not in a lifetime. At a time. All a Muslim man has to do to divorce his wife is say, you are divorced three times in a row, and she is divorced. And then he can marry another one. They have a lot of children out of every wife. Today, the average Islamic family throughout the world is 10 children.
I believe you said in your book, Osama bin Laden had, what, 56 children?
He is one out of 53 children.
53.
He himself has 27. And we haven't even started talking about his other 52 brothers and sisters and how many children they have.
So there are a lot of bin Ladens around, huh?
There are a lot of bin Ladens around.
And so you're saying that the very high excessive birth rate is what helped them to become the majority?
Yes, it's their high birth rate, and also us opening our borders and welcoming Muslims into our country, us thinking, you know, they're gonna love our way of life. I mean, all the Arab sheikhs used to come to Lebanon with their family to vacation and party because my country offered them the freedom that their countries forbid. Like I mentioned, the Muslims who came to study in our country, they graduated and worked in our economy. But also what aggravated the situation. See, we always had the situation contained between the Muslim Lebanese and the Christian Lebanese. But what aggravated the situation was the influx of the Palestinians into Lebanon, especially out of Jordan in the 1970s, when Lebanon was the only country to accept the third wave of Palestinian refugees into the country. While their Muslim brothers did not want them, we, the Christian Lebanon, took them in.
So you are saying that the situation may proceed without much difficulty, providing that the Muslims are not yet ready to make their move, and
right.
they are inferior regarding numbers. But once they gain the upper hand, that's when everything changes.
Exactly. Once they gained the upper hands, once the Palestinian came to Lebanon and the Muslims became the majority, they put their heads together and they declared jihad in the country.
In other words, they said, we're going to take over this nation.
We're going to take over this nation. What Yasser Arafat wanted to do was basically create a base from which to fight Israel, kill the Jews and throw them into the sea. Something he tried to do in Jordan but failed because of the dictatorship of the king. We in Lebanon took him in, and he was able to use our democracy, our open-mindedness, our fair, our tolerance, our multiculturalism against us to topple our democracy. We, the Christians, refused to read the writings on the wall. We refused to listen to what our enemy was saying. We judged our enemy based on our own standards. We could not believe that even though our enemy was telling us exactly what they wanted to do, we could not believe that they mean it. We would always come up with our own translation of what they're trying to say.
Well, that's just what's happening in America today.
This is exactly what is happening in America today. America, as an open society, as a fair society, as a tolerant society, as a multicultural society, as an open border society, look at what's happening through the borders, which I will touch on later as we get into what's happening in our country. But I see the same signs in America. Our enemy today is telling us exactly what they want to do. You listen to the Al-Qaeda tapes, you listen to Al-Zawahiri, you listen to Al-Zarqawi, you listen to Osama bin Laden, you listen to Gaddam. All the tapes that are coming out of Al-Qaeda are saying, we want to establish an Islamic Khalifa, we want to spread Islam all throughout the world, this is a holy war. They're not hiding it.
So you're hearing the same rhetoric now as it regards this nation as you heard as a little girl back in Lebanon.
Exactly.
A few years ago.
Exactly. And in Lebanon,
go ahead.
Once the Muslims became the majority and they got the upper hand, they organized, they came out publicly. Those who used to say that we're moderates, you know, only the radical Palestinians are doing this, all of a sudden, the moderates, quote unquote, the doctors, the lawyers, the educated Muslims, our next door neighbors, who used to come to our barbecue picnics the weekend before, were doing the massacring the weekend after, once the call of jihad was declared.
Okay, Muslims who you thought were your friends.
Yes.
Muslims who y'all broke bread together.
Yeah.
The children played together, and you thought they would never hurt us. Is that about right?
That's exactly
it. And what happened whenever war began?
Once the Muslims gathered, they formed an army called Jaish Lebanon al-Arabi, the Arabic Lebanese army. Again, Arab in the Middle East refers only to Muslims. The word Arabic, because Islam spread out of Arabia throughout the world, as Muslims conquered nations, they basically forced those nations either to convert to Islam or adopt Islamic culture and language. Do you know that in Arabic today, when Christians pray, they pray for Allah? This is the word, supposedly in Arabic, for God.
Yeah.
So in the
yeah.
Bible and in Christian churches, when Christians pray, they pray for Allah. In many different countries, people here in the United States do not realize that the Christians of the Middle East are not Arabs. They are basically groups of Christians that were forced and subjugated under Islam. For example, in Lebanon, if you go to our churches today, we still speak the Aramaic language in our churches. Our church services are conducted throughout the world.
In Aramaic?
Today, in the 21st century, in Aramaic, the language that
Jesus
spoke.
Jumping ahead a few years at what is taking place in Lebanon right now, the Lebanese government that's trying to gain the upper hand there, what's going on there now? Who is what?
Well, basically now, Hezbollah is in control. Hezbollah basically multiplied themselves for the last 25 years to be able to vote themselves into the government. See, this is again why the multiplication in numbers becomes so important, because once these people start voting, they basically voted themselves into the government. Mm-hmm. About 25 seats into the government are now occupied by Hezbollah. Mm. And what they're trying to do is overthrow the Lebanese government and take over the government.
Now, you were raised, really, and reading your book, you were raised, to be blunt, to hate the Jews.
Well, yes, Lebanon as a country, we thought...
In those years of long ago.
Yes, those years as long ago. Now, I was a very young child. In my home, I was not taught hatred because I was raised in a Christian family.
Yeah.
Christians do not raise their kids to hate, because what did Jesus taught? Jesus taught love. But the culture around me, because by the time I was a child in the 70s, the majority of the people in Lebanon were Muslims. Mm-hmm. And they...
But as a child, you really hadn't even seen a Jew, I suppose.
No, no. I've never seen a Jew until the war broke out.
What were you taught, what little you were? Like you said, your parents were Christians. They didn't teach you hate per se, but that aura or spirit was there in the country, I'm assuming.
Right, right. I remember my father had a restaurant, and I would watch television in the restaurant every night. And the news would be about the horrible Israelis, the horrible Jews, and what they're doing to the Palestinians. And of course, Lebanon, as a country who took in the Palestinian refugees, you know, Israel was vilified. So all the media in the Arabic world is controlled by the governments. Our government thought that if they would befriend or suck up to the Arabic government, that that would buy us protection or brownie points as a minority in the Middle East. Israel protected us and Israel came in the middle of the night. But it wasn't until 1982, when my mother was wounded and we ended up taking her to Israeli hospital for treatment, that I was able to get in touch with the Israelis one-on-one and get to know them.
How far was it from your home to the hospital in Israel, northern
Israel? It was an hour away from my home.
About 50 miles.
And my mother was wounded as Israel invaded Lebanon. And the only reason, by the way, Israel invaded Lebanon in 1982 was because Syria and Iran had gotten involved in the war in Lebanon. And Syria was supporting and propping the terrorist organization. And Syria was shelling Israel using Lebanese territories, calling it the Lebanese resistance. We had nothing to do with it. Now, when I hear our president talking about the axis of evil, Syria and Iran meddling in the Lebanese government, I think to myself, where has America been for the last 30 years? The war in Lebanon was not a war between the Christian Lebanese and the Muslim Lebanese. It was a war between the Christian Lebanese trying to protect their democracy and the Muslims coming from all around the Arabic world, such as from Egypt and Syria and Saudi Arabia and Jordan, in order to create a base for radical Muslims to create a war to spread throughout the world.
Okay, I noticed you use the term radical Muslims. Why do you use that term?
I shouldn't use that term.
That's what I'm getting at.
That is a term we need to get out of our vocabulary.
That's what I'm getting at.
That term is sometimes used because people just tuning into the TV stations, and if you talk about Muslims in general, they're going to be offended because they haven't heard the beginning of the conversation.
Yeah, right.
But when we talk about Islam, when you read the Quran, you realize that the radicals who are killing themselves and blowing themselves up are not truly radical. That is mainstream Islam.
Yeah.
The radicals that we call radicals, who are blowing themselves up, are basically good practicing Muslims who are following the teachings of their Quran, their holy book, and doing exactly what the Prophet Muhammad, whom they consider al-insan al-kamil, the perfect man, had ordered them to do, and that is to kill the infidel, declare war on the infidel, behead them, terrorize them, smite over their necks, cut off their necks and smite them on their fingers and toes because they disobeyed Allah. These are the teachings of the Quran, right, and the words of the Prophet Muhammad. So we need to stop looking at radicals and moderates and start looking at practicing Muslims and non-practicing Muslim. A practicing Muslim is a Muslim that goes to mosque every Friday, a Muslim that prays five times a day. A practicing Muslim is a Muslim that believes a woman is his property, according to the Quran, that he, as a practicing Muslim, has the right to kill his wife, rape his wife, beat his wife, and do the same thing to his daughters and every female member of the family.
Okay, tell us a little bit about, how do you pronounce the Sharia law? Sharia law?
Sharia law.
Okay.
And Sharia law is basically what the Quran teaches, because in Quran is a totalitarian ideology. There is no difference and no separation between the church or the mosque and state. The state is the mosque and the mosque is the state. There is no separation.
Right.
And Sharia law, Islam orders, according to the Quran, that all Muslims must live by the teachings of the Quran. And these are the teachings of the Quran. And this is why in Islamic societies, women have no right. Islam is not compatible with democracy. A non-practicing Muslim, or what we would call a moderate Muslim, is a Muslim who does not believe the Quran literally, is a Muslim who does not believe that he has a right to rape or kill his wife or subjugate his wife.
Well, there are many of them like that. Many Muslims that do not subscribe to the murder, the rape, the raping, the killing, the slaughter, the bloodletting, and so forth.
Yes, there are. There are a lot of Muslims that are like that. There are a lot of Muslims in the West who respect the West.
Are they making themselves heard?
No, they're not making themselves heard. And those who are making themselves heard, the few who are writing books, who are speaking about it, are basically your average citizens who are not getting support from any Islamic organization and who are not even getting support from our Western media, because when they come out and speak against Muslims and call a spade and call it by its name, Islam, they are called Islamophobes by our Islamic media on our college campuses, and they are being shunned. So those we need to support to sound the alarms basically are being suppressed, are being silenced in the name of multiculturalism and tolerance.
Do these individuals, are they beginning, these so-called moderate Muslims, are they beginning to get the idea as one article was printed in Newsweek magazine, and I can't pronounce the man's name who printed it, but he was a Muslim. He said, it might be time for us to look at our religion. Something is wrong with our religion. And I'm wondering, are there many moderates that are beginning to think through their religion? Because everything they do is based, as you said, on the Quran. Am I right?
Yes.
That's their foundation. That's everything that they do.
That's the anchor.
But when you look at the Quran, I haven't studied it but a tiny bit, but it advocates all the things that we're discussing here, murder, slaughter, torture, terrorism. It all comes from the Quran. Am I correct?
Correct. And it comes from the Quran, and the Pentagon did a study last year. And this is out of the Pentagon. And they concluded that all the terrorist attacks and what is driving terrorism around the world right now is basically the holy book of the Quran. Now, this study is controversial.
But they don't dare say anything about it.
They wouldn't. You didn't hear the media report about it. I mean, this is a Pentagon report. This is a Pentagon study. So because they are dealing with terrorists, they are capturing it. They are interrogating them. Look at all the terrorists we are capturing. They are screaming Allahu Akbar before they kill themselves. They are doing it for the sake of Allah. Our enemy is not mincing words. They are not politically correct. They are so bold in their faith. They are so bold in their belief, and they're telling us exactly what they're doing and why and what's the base for them doing it. We are not listening because we believe all religions are good. All religions are not good.
No, they're not.
In Christianity, we had some very nasty verses in our Old Testament, if you read our Bible. However, and a lot of ugly things have been done in the name of Christianity. However, we as Jews and Christians have reformed our religion. We realize that in the 21st century, we are not going to go behead people, kill people, because we believe we need to talk to people. We Christians, and you as an evangelist, will be the first person to condemn anybody who would strap bombs on their bodies,
right,
Jim, and go out
right,
and blow a mosque.
Right, right.
Because we as Christians do not agree with killing and torturing
right.
and raping.
And we believe that Muslims, we should pray for them.
That's right.
And if we have contact with them, they should be treated kindly and graciously.
Absolutely.
But we should also at the same time know the truth about what Islam really is.
Here's what I say. Be as kind as dove and as wise as serpents.
We must be
kind to our brothers, no matter who they are, from what religion they come from. We must be kind to them. But let's not confuse being kind with being wise. You can be wise. You can be suspicious. You can be vigilant. But you can still be kind.
We've got just a few minutes left here. And you're constantly speaking all over the world, really. Am I right?
Correct.
And all the way from the President of the United States to the Parliament in Great Britain to heads of state and other places, plus churches, plus wherever. I saw you the other day addressing some part of the military college.
The Joint Forces Command.
Right, right. And it was interesting, the young man who stood up and said he had served in the Army for I don't know how many years, but was a Muslim. Did you remember that, I'm sure?
Actually, thank you for bringing that up, because that person that stood up and asked that question in an American military uniform with an American flag on his arm was actually a Saudi commander on an exchange program in our government. This is what he did not say on camera on C-SPAN for the public who are watching to hear. And he was speaking about how he was a moderate Muslim and a practicing Muslim, but he forgot to mention, I'm a Saudi raised on Wahhabism, and I'm on an exchange program with your government so we can learn how you guys do tactical combat for terrorism. And I believe it is a sin, it is a crime to allow Saudi generals
to be in our training
in our government, especially in high sensitive positions.
Exactly. Yes.
And to add insult to injury, dress in our uniforms, because when that man stood on C-SPAN and asked that question, you would think he's your next door Muslim neighbor who's a loving American, practicing American, patriotic American serving our country.
I thought he was. I thought he was a member of our armed forces. You see, nobody said anything about that. And
exactly.
I noticed, did you know that before or after?
I knew that before. Actually, the C-SPAN session that C-SPAN aired was the question-answer session at the end of the day.
I see.
I had training sessions with these commanders, about 80 of them in the first session, for 2 hours.
What was their reaction to you?
Most of them, they understand the problem. They are very aware of the problem. And of course, I was detailing the fact in my previous two-hour detailed session, the involvement, the penetration of Saudi Arabia into our government, into our university systems, financing the mosques and supporting cells within our country to perpetrate terrorism attacks in our country and the world, and the Saudi financing to terrorism. This guy was sitting in the audience, livid with my statements. The American commanders loved what I was saying. Of course, with their position in a uniform, they cannot say anything. Right, they have to be politically correct. Right. Actually, to the point that the commander who invited me had to change the subject a little bit. And he says, well, we're talking a lot about Saudi Arabia. Why don't we just talk about other countries like Indonesia? He felt so concerned that I have blown the whistle with Saudis sitting in the crowd.
I know we're coming to an end. She summed it up in her book. The attitude of the Americans that they need to understand is a statement that's prevalent in all of Islam. Saturday is coming and then Sunday.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. In Islam, every child and every Christian in the Middle East are raised with this sentence. أولاً يأتي السبت وبعده الأحد. First comes Saturday, then comes Sunday. First we kill the Jews,
Saturday.
Then we come for the Christians.
Sunday.
What starts with the Jews never ends with the Jews. And the world now is seeing this because the world turned a blind eye to evil. When Jewish blood was being shed on the streets of Tel Aviv and Jerusalem, nobody really gave a darn. Who cares about what happens in Israel? It doesn't affect us. But what we are seeing today is that the same enemy that Israel's been fighting for over 55 years is the enemy that now the whole world is fighting.
Yeah,
and because we turned a blind eye to that evil back there, now this evil has come to our shores and is fighting us here.
I want to deal with we mentioned the Saudis, and that is if you want to. Deal with the manner in which the Saudi government concerning our oil billions are buying their way into our corporations, into our media, into our universities, and thereby being able to persuade in directions that they so desire due to their influx of oil money, incidentally, which came from the taxpayers of this country. Second, I want to look at political correctness as well. And thirdly, I want to look at next week at, from your vast experience, what do you think that this nation should do? Now, my contention is, you know, will we do it? I'm afraid that we'll continue to be not Uncle Sam, but rather Uncle Sap. And that's pretty well what we are, mostly. But what you feel like the nation should do and what steps we ought to take as it regards the scourge, because it's quite possible now. And my contention is that, well, let me say this first, that an atomic bomb, we have atomic bombs now that are about the size of a softball. It could take out New York City, Washington, D.C., any major city, hundreds of thousands of casualties. Will it take that to wake this nation up to the evils of the religion of Islam? Are the Muslims, are they making such headway without doing that due to their encroachment into this nation by other means that they're thinking it's not much point in us doing it, or does their religion demand that they steal and kill and destroy? This particular situation, as a child and then growing up in it, she was not Muslim. She was born in Lebanon, raised there, and raised as a Christian, to be frank with you. But her whole world was surrounded by the religion of Islam. Her book, entitled Because They Hate, is, I think, personally, the most informative book that you could ever read as it regards an understanding of the religion of Islam, what it's all about, and what is taking place in this country today, and the danger that our country is facing. The danger that our country is facing. I made the statement last week, I'll make it again now. I feel like this great United States, the land of the brave, the home of the free, is in greater danger, threatened now to a greater degree than ever before in our history. And you might ask, how could that be, considering the past, the Cold War, Pearl Harbor, and so forth. For this reason, it's perfectly possible now for an atomic bomb the size of a softball to be taken in a suitcase or even a handbag almost and detonated in New York City, Washington, D.C., Denver, Colorado, Los Angeles, Chicago, wherever, with hundreds of thousands of casualties. And there are millions of individuals in the religion of Islam who want to do just that. And will it take that to wake us up? That's the reason I'm saying that our nation is in greater danger today, I believe, than it's ever been before in its history. Let's have a word of prayer as we begin today. Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you. Thank you for our guest who jeopardizes her life every single hour of every single day by the stand that she has taken and is taking. I would pray, Lord, that you would watch over her, protect her. This nation and the world needs her voice.